Does anyone wants to volunteer last minute for the lottery? I guess JP.
Dennis is out now, right?
Yeah. Am I sharing already my screen?
No,
I'm not getting it.
Okay. So that leaves Dennis, Eduardo, Victor, me, JP is out, I guess, unless he wants to
write about himself.
Write about my own stuff. Okay.
So is it just the four of us?
Yeah, perhaps.
Or did oh no, sorry, Dennis was already picked, so it's just Eduardo, me, and Victor.
Unless anyone else wants to.
Yeah.
Do anyone want to volunteer for the lottery? Like, you know what this is, everybody? Like, usually, yeah, there's some people coming in. Oh, Julia Thompson. Yeah. Usually we do this lottery and the person who gets picked is the one who write a blog entry about the current presentation. So
if one, yeah, it's just like any note or comment or review or summary.
Yeah, we're kind of reducing options because everybody owes already a blog entry about our past presentations.
Did anyone?
Nobody?
Okay, so that.
You can add me.
Where is this posted? Yeah, it's a blog. There will be a blog. Corey wants to do it.
Great. Is this Corey? Like this?
Corey's the room.
I just diminished my chances.
You want to have it?
I'm not sure. No, I'm not sure. Okay, should I spin then?
Nobody else?
Dolly uma, dolly duas.
Yeah, it's Cassia. Like Cassia.
Cassia and Caio.
Cassia and Caio, okay.
Ah, Cassia and Caio.
We have a crowd now.
Ah, that's awesome.
An alliterative crowd.
Okay, nice. Okay, we can. So, last chances. Anyone else? This is way more fun than doing it before.
We should do it in the beginning of each session. This is way much better.
Okay, so let's do it.
We should have a music like for when it's spinning.
Oh. Yeah, you got it.
Yay!
I mean, when you said you had lesser chances, when you said you had lesser chances, that was the moment that fate latched onto you.
Yeah, my fate was sealed.
It's a birthday gift from the SCP to you.
Okay.
You know the drill. Like, you can pick any aspect of the presentation. So if you like the Gato Tosco text, you might just write about that. So should I start sharing and all everything else? Yeah. Perhaps. Let me see. Yeah. It's here. So can you see this? Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
So this is noise and social synthesis. This all started because I was rereading Attali's Noise, which is a fairly controversial textbook. There was this strange correspondence to Caratani's modes of intercross. Actually, my original plan was to talk about something else, which was a comparison that will be featured here in, as a case study between cage and cardio. But this, yeah, I wanted really to check if, you know, there is something to be done still with Attali's noise, in a sense. So this is kind of a project of this presentation, which is very tentative yet. I just finished rereading the book. I read it a few years ago. I didn't like it at the time, but I'm seeing stuff now that I didn't see at the time. So this is the issue. Okay, who's Attali? So before he was the head of European Bank of Reconstruction and Development, and before he was an economic advisor to French President François Mitterrand, Jacques Attali wrote a strange book that was hugely influential within peculiar circles, Noise, the Political Economy of Music, Oui, essai sur l'économie politique de la musique. The book appeared in French in the late 70s amid a flurry of intellectual innovations that had been spawned by the newly apparent political possibilities following the uproar of 1968. In this atmosphere in which ideas of how the world could be transformed seemed to be spilling out of every sector of culture, while formal institutions tried to play catch up, music stood out to Attali as the most powerful and the most under-theorized source for understanding the forces of production that create the world around us. And as he studied, it became apparent to him that this was not a new phenomenon. Indeed, it has always been the case. So this is a blog entry that I found that I think is fairly well written about, very quick about Attali, who Attali is. In a sense, why is he so controversial? Because, you know, of his, you know, public, you know, affairs and stuff like that, being head of the European Bank of Reconstruction Development and all that, and also finance advisor to Mitterrand. So there is a very rabid polemic against him by Jacques Attali in that book that Urbanomic published, that they translated To Live Like Pigs. What was it called? To Think and Live Like Pigs.
To Live and Think Like Pigs, yeah.
But I'll touch upon very briefly on that by the end of the presentation, because this has to do with what Attali is defending as his fourth mode, like his mode D sorts, which he calls composition. So this was part of my infatuation with his hypothesis, because it has this interesting overlap with what STP was doing with Caravan. So. And I wanted to verify it, in a sense. So there's this criticism of Attali. Firstly, Jacques Attali's noise. This is from Inigo Wilkins, Irreversible Noise, as yet unpublished book that is also announced forever on the Urbanomic site. But this was in the thesis version in 2016. Firstly, Jacques Attali's Noise, A Political Economy of Music, which describes the political economy of music in terms of historical epochs, whose transition thresholds are prophetically announced by new musical forms, which appear as noise to mainstream tastes. This links the scientific and economic conception of the information noise nexus to the domain of aesthetics. However, not merely are there numerous problems, both with Attali's conception of noise and with his analysis of its political economy, but really the whole conceptual framework that he departs from must be rejected as stemming from an illegitimate overextension of the concept of noise, bound up with a fetishization of self-organizing systems and an exaltation of noise, of chance, sorry. So, of course, Inigo Wilkins is coming from, you know, the more contemporary critique of indeterminacy that we find in his work, in Cecil Malaspina's work about noise as well. And the way they are kind of mobilizing scientific concepts of noise that stem from information theory and cybernetics, and the differences between these conceptualizations of noise, which in a certain sense is strange, because, you know, in Attali's book from 1977, he actually doesn't really takes account of, it's much more like a kind of a fluctuating use of the predicate noise as something that is not accounted for within a certain kind of indexation, I'd say. And this would be something, some way that we could make this in a certain sense more rigorous within our, or within the toolkit that we are using. The idea of indexation of the inexistent that I actually already presented something on music from that formalism that comes from Badiou's logic supports. So in a sense, if we take it not so much as being noise, but as being kind of the unaccounted, the unindexed, the unencoded, or the inexistent, in Badiou's term, most of the problems, of the conceptual problems, seem to disappear with Attali's, but we'll get to that. Well, agreeing with the first sentence, like this presentation of what Attali wanted to do, the intent of this presentation is, Attali's rhetoric notwithstanding, to verify if it's possible to defend some of his propositions by introducing a few redefinitions of scope into his concept. So I want to understand, let us say, what's the invariations that are at place for him to come up with this overarching kind of history of music in its relationship to noise, and also with this ingredient that actually it's quite central to his account, which is political economy. So in a sense, it's not the one of the problems is that he does not an immanent account of the inclusion of noise by music in terms of the truth procedure of music or of art or whatever. It is much more kind of tethered to the valorization of music within commodity exchange as well. So in a sense, it's a more complex structure than just describing the different dynamics that music suffers in its relation to its outside or its other, or something like that. Right. So an important thing for this idea that I want to present today is this concept of social synthesis. Most of you are already familiar with it. Social forms develop and change. So also does the synthesis which holds together the multiplicity of links operating between men according to the division of labor. Every society made up of a plurality of individuals is a network coming into effect through their actions. How they act is of primary importance for the social network. What they think is of secondary importance. Their activities must interrelate in order to fit into a society and must contain at least a minimum of uniformity if the society is to function as a whole. This coherence can be conscious or unconscious, but exist it must. Otherwise, society would cease to be viable and the individuals would come to grief as a result of their multiple dependencies upon one another. Expressed in very general terms, this is a precondition for the survival of every kind of society. It formulates what I term social synthesis. This notion is thus nothing other than a constituent part of the Marxian concept of social formation, a part which, in the course of my long preoccupation with historical forms of thinking, has become indispensable to my understanding of man's social conditions. So this is on Hattel's main paragraph about social synthesis. In a certain sense, I think one of the ingredients that must come to bear upon what Attali is saying is this idea of a certain social synthesis. So when I say it's not just the relationship of music and dissonance, or music and the unmusical, or the indexing of the unindexed, but it is that under the assumption of a function for music within the social synthesis, which becomes a synthesis operated by the commodity exchange, I think you get a more rich kind of description of why is it also that, you know, the concept of noise in the book seems to undergo a few changes. You know, so this is not when you get to the second mode of his mode B. I'm jumping ahead a little bit here because I'm kind of freestyling all over the material. But when he gets to representation, in a certain sense, it's not only, you know, the pure relation of music and its outside anymore. It's like the relationship of music, its outside, a boundary between what is a professional activity of music making and the valorization in terms of exchange value of this professional kind of spectacle. So few more ingredients enter into the mix, and then, you know, it's not just really the relationship between that noise and music anymore, right? It's between a certain usage and its entrance in the world of, you know, exchange, commodity exchange also, which will be central to every other mode in Attali's account. Only the first mode is, you know, antediluvian in a certain sense. It's the sacrificial mode. So here I'm rehearsing Caratani's from the Atlas, our text, the way the Atlas presents it. I'm rehearsing Caratani's modes of exchange. So Caratani defines his four modes as follows. Mode A is defined by the logic of pooling and reciprocity. Its main social form is that of a gift and the contra-gift. Its normative structure is that of customs and rules, valid primarily within communities. Its main form of hierarchy is that of honor. Its basic collective structure is the household, further expanded into settlements composed of households and federations composed of settlements. When it is the dominant mode, it is able to scale up and integrate social groups to form mini systems. Mode B is defined by the logic of plunder and redistribution. Its main social form is that of domination and protection between communities. Its normative structure is that of laws imposed by dominant communities over the subservient ones. Its main hierarchical structure is that of status. Its collective structure is that of cities, further divided into centers, margins, submargins, and communities which are out of sphere, outside the reach of its power. When it is in the dominant mode, it is able to scale up and integrate communities into world empires. Mode C is defined by the logic of commodity exchange. Its basic social form is that of value and money commodities. It works not by social rules or laws, but by tendencies which constrain the flow and reproduction of commodities. Its hierarchical structure is that of social classes, and its basic collective form is that of the market. When it is the dominant mode, we call this social formation a capitalist one, and its total extent across centers, semi-peripheries, and peripheries, note the absence of an outside, forming a world economy. So this is the first three modes, according to Caratani. And of course, we have a very familiar debate about the fourth mode, like Caratani has this mode D, and we have in the SCP come up with a different account of what would be mode D, which for Caratani is basically communism or free associationism, but it comes in Caratani's system. I'm saying this for the outsiders here, okay, guys, because this is all, you know, it's part of our toolkit. It comes in Caratani's thinking as a regulative idea, sort. So it's not really a real mode that was instantiated. He see glimpses of that in religion, in religious communities, and of course the socialist movement and all that. In the STP, there is this cases of, you know, organization, org is bigger than K, which kind of replaces the mode D, which is actually thesis about the dynamic of really existing communities and the visibility that they enable. So the idea is that if you consider the world seen by from the standpoint of organizations that are the space of organizations that is bigger than the dominant logic of the world, you get more information. So there is a debate whether this is sufficient for, you know, being what we call the communist hypothesis that we presented as a communist hypothesis in two texts, or if this is a condition for a communist hypothesis. Anyway, this is part of a different presentation, one that a couple of which we done already. So can go back to that and discuss it anyway. And it seems to be a part also of a presentation that I will do with Moscardi at some point. So comparing Attali's framework to Caratani's framework, here's a relevant quotation from Attali's book. In this book, I would like to trace the political economy of music as a succession of orders. In other words, differences done violence by noises. In other words, the calling into question of differences that are prophetic because they create new orders, unstable and changing. Briefly, we will see that it is possible to distinguish our map, three zones, three stages, three strategic usages of music by power. In one of these zones, it seems that music is used and produced in the ritual in an attempt to make people forget the general violence. In another, it is employed to make people believe in the harmony of the world, that there is order in exchange and legitimacy in commercial power. And finally, there is one in which it serves to silence by mass producing a deafening, syncretic kind of music and censoring all other human noises. Make people forget, make them believe, silence them. In all three cases, music is a tool of power, of ritual power, when it is a question of making people forget the fear of violence, of representative power, when it is a question of making them believe in order and harmony, and of bureaucratic, I'm not sure I agree with that characterization, but anyway, it's a bureaucratic power, when it is a question of silencing those who oppose it. Thus, music localizes and specifies power because it marks and regiments the rare noises that cultures in their normalization of behavior see it to authorize. Music accounts for them, it makes them audible. So music in a certain sense is a kind of a work on a kind of material. This material, you know, are indexed within the world of music according to, you know, what does culture in question see fit to authorize, as Attali says. And this relationship has like three different modes. I believe you can discern them already there, like the ritual mode, which corresponds to the idea of the community, of a gift economy in a certain sense. I believe Karatani remembers the ritual sacrifice as a kind of gift by which nature is it's a gift by which you make nature from a thou into a it in a certain sense, because it can't really reciprocate. And by doing so, you are able to control nature. In a certain sense, you can rephrase this relationship in terms of, okay, I'm indexing this, you know, this other intentionality that is kind of a threat into my, you know, human world that I can then proceed with the metabolism that I need to the survival of the community in a certain sense. So the sacrifice, you know, in a certain sense, falls squarely into the gift economy. Of course, there is a problem of, you know, the kind of periodization and definition. Karatani also says that sacrifices are much more important in settled communities, not in nomad communities. Whereas Attali sometimes has this kind of romantic attachment with nomadism that I'm not sure it makes sense. The same sense or the same, you know, has the same kind of purview to talk about, you know, sacrifice in, you know, nomadic communities. This is maybe, I'm ignorant about it, but anyway, this is something that pops into my mind in terms of the precision of, you know, the periodization, history that Attali is using. So mode B, as I was saying, like in Attali becomes a representation, which is kind of tricky, but it's tricky in a way that is respects actually what is supposed to be the objective of, for instance, Karatani's framework, which is in representation. It's not really a pure mode, of course. It is a representation comes about through the advent of commodity exchange bearing into, you know, the activity of music making. But what is interesting then, it's like, of course, we would then be tempted to locate representation as mode C because of the element of commodity exchange. But actually what is characteristic of representation is the fact that it draws a boundary between an inside and outside, and the entrance to which is gained through the exchanging money values, right? So it's weird, like it's like this mix between, of course, it's the advent of commodity exchange, but also kind of tethered to an idea of a boundary that is characteristic of mode B of representation that, of course, lends itself to an interpretation in terms of representative power or representative democracy or the, you know, the modern state, the formation of the modern state. in a certain sense, but in the way that it is tethered, it is kind of enmeshed with the development of commodity exchange. So representation then, in my view, would correspond to mode B. And then there's this thing that is, you know, repetition. We'll be talking a bit, quite a bit about it, which is the third mode that comes about with the advent of the recording of the phonograph. You see, you can record and play back musical content. Therefore, you can, you know, reproduce all kinds of sounds and music and all of that. And this ends up challenging the paradigm of representation in the sense that it's not about a boundary that you come in to experience a spectacle anymore. It's not about representation. This is why he calls it repetition. It's like this dissemination of copies in the social tissue. That, you know, and there are specific kind of strategies that, you know, political economy have to follow to ensure that there is still a demand for these, you know, these contents. We'll be talking a little bit about that. Okay. But then this would be my candidate for mode C within the Attali framework. And then there's mode D and composition. I'm leaving the fourth mode for after. So here's the comparison. Like a sacrifice in mode A, pooling and reciprocity, representation mode B, plunder and redistribution, repetition mode C, commodity exchange, and composition mode D, X, according to Attali. And the periodization question that I thought it was kind of weird. But for there is this kind of very big history before representation, like, you know, sacrifice, everything before was sacrificed. Attali gets into a few kind of details about the activity of jongleurs, minstrels, and this kind of thing, and also the different positions a musician ends up occupying within sacrifice, yet, and then in the passage to representation, for instance. There is a kind of middle term there when the musician is not a vagabond anymore, or a jongleur. He becomes domestic in the service of, you know, a court or something like that. So he sells his body, actually. He's kind of a property of the court and produces on demand for the court, right? When representation comes, develops, the idea is that he becomes a professional in a certain sense, selling his expertise, so to speak, in the market, in a sense. So one very, very, you know, paradigmatic example of that is Beethoven, right? You know, Beethoven is usually mentioned when you talk about that, the fact that he's not at the service of any, you know, prince anymore. He's just in the market and people are commissioning new works from him, and this idea of commissioning new works end up, you know, enforcing a set of concepts that have to be there in order for the transaction to occur. For instance, the, you know, one of the discussions that we've been having, not really continuously, like I had a few discussions about this with SKP, and it's been quite a while we don't talk about this, which is the idea of the problem of the ontology of musical works, right? Like this was the subject of my thesis, you know, in a distant past. Actually, one of the most interesting accounts of this problem is that, you know, instead of looking for a metaphysical explanation of what is a musical work, which is even the metaphysics that you use to explain it is kind of difficult because, for instance, you have to account for the fact that you have a relationship of one in many with the musical work. Like you have many representations or many performances. At the same time, they are all cases of one. And then you have like different solutions to that problem. For instance, nominalistic solutions within, you know, analytic philosophy, which is concerned with this problem, contemporarily with this problem of the ontology of musical works. have like a nominalistic solutions that, you know, would say something to the extent that there is no abstract objects to which performances correspond. You have, what you have is a score, and, you know, performances are enacting a replica of the score because you want to actually deflation. It's a deflationary kind of approach, and you're trying to deflate the abstract object because, you know, the idea of many in one in a certain sense already lends itself to Platonism very easily. So you have like this great plethora of, you know, Platonist philosophers talking about the musical works in terms of, you know, the exemplars of an abstract object. But if it is an abstract object, then the object cannot be created. So actually the composer discovers the object. So you see, like, the problem is you have many different solutions to this issue that in a certain sense end up creating more problems than solutions. And the idea of, you know, the work concept coming about because you need a nexus, a social nexus for the social synthesis of which the selling of a work in the market is a problem, is a kind of an elegant solution, right? And this comes about, of course, it is a concept in the social sphere, in the way I think about it within this, you know, analytic pragmatist kind of philosophy. Of course, it is something that is, because it is believed in a certain sense, it is enforced, but also you have like concrete practices that enforce it, for instance, copyright laws. And for instance, one of the most important elements for representation according to Attali is the invention of the print. So you can print scores. And then there's this debate in the representation chapter of the book about where is the word? Is it, you know, the printed score or the printed copy? Who owns the rights? Is it the composer? Is it the company that makes the print? And then you have this discussion about the changes in legislation of these problems between the 600s and the 1900s, which is an interesting bit of the book that I won't be covering, but it's much more historical. So he says, like, representation is you know, in the face of what he calls competitive capitalism. And repetition comes about with the advent of recording technology, and it's still lingering in the time of his writing in 1977. And there's this composition thing that is his futuristic speculation about, you know, the breaking point of the commodity exchange kind of domination over music production. You will notice that I'm not really addressing the fact that he says that the relationship between music and noise prefigures, foreshadows what the political economy will be doing, because I'm not sure about this thesis, actually. I fail to see really a nexus between these things. I mean, it's you can make the case, but it is a contingent kind of case that, for instance, representation, he sees representation corresponding to a certain kind of musical language, which is the formation of the tonal system, right, like in the 1600s exactly. And the idea that this tonal system is a kind of administration of dissonance, wherein dissonance has a kind of, in our parlance, like a low transcendental value. Like, dissonance is something to be controlled by the consonances in the system, and this is forms a system of harmony. There was no really system of harmony as such before you know, the formation of this tonal system in a more overt and explicit manner. You had like the laws of counterpoint and then a certain kind of ambiguity regarding what counts as a resolution of a dissonance, and, you know, these kind of things. So for him, representation corresponds to this phase also of, you know, the ideological phase, the phase wherein you kind of are masking the dissonance with the appearance of harmony, a harmonious whole that the work concept is able also to offer. And this foreshadows, you know, 19th century political economy. Like, I think this is quite forced, but anyway, yeah. So two ideas suggested. The second idea, the first idea is this comparison between Attali and Caratani, which is interesting to me and hopefully to us, sorry. And the second idea, what is Attali's concept of noise, which is something I was already discussing briefly. So returning to Inigo Wilkins' critique, there is an immediately political dimension to the existing literature on the concept of noise, where it is associated with the uncontrolled element of or uncontrollable force that leads to revolutionary transformation. Noise is frequently alluded to as the irrepressible chaos of the multitude or of desire against the forces of oppression and repression. This is exemplified by the repression concept of the Klineman found in Serre and Deleuze, the micropolitics of desire in Deleuze and Gattari, and its development in the radical post-Marxist tradition of Italian autonomism. Attali is not quoted there, but he's quoted right after this paragraph as somebody that is in this, you know, longueur d'onde, in this, you know, wavelength. Wilkins criticized this for, you know, not taking into account the, you know, scientific use of noise. He's also not, it's not only Gilles Châtelet, but he's also drawing from Renéton. Renéton has this also very intense polemics against the, you know, what he called the folks that from the order out of chaos folks, right? The order out of chaos crowd, like Henri Atlan and Jacques Monod and what is this guy that I find really boring? Edgar Morin. And Renéton is always saying that, you know, noise is relative to a system of representation and things like that. So Inigo Wilkins is insisting upon this, you know, relativity to a framework. And even depending on the framework, you know, the noise will be a certain amount of noise will be necessary to account for what is informative, for instance, in, you know, informational noise, which is also the subject of Cecil Malaspina's book, incidentally. Whereas in other kind of accounts, for instance, in second order cybernetics, noise is a certain, it's the unwanted thing, you know, that has to be controlled in order for the system to retain its integrity. So there are different, by these different frameworks, you get to certain kinds of inversion in terms of how you think about noise, in terms of, is it unwanted or is it part of what is necessary for, you know, what you are trying to do, for instance. So there are a bunch of different uses of noise. I had also a diagram that I thought it was not as good. At some point we can develop it about these different concepts of noise. The point is that Attali for me is not using any of those, in fact. So Wilkins is criticizing him for not being scientific, but at the same time, I think he's talking about the indexation or encoding of something and encoded in a certain sense. And he calls it noise. Not sure if it is really noise that is important here in his account. So this music localizes and specifies power because it marks and regiments the rare noise in the cultures in their normalization behavior see fit to authorize. Music accounts for them, it makes them audible. Instead of seeing noise as a site of resistance against control, we could try and think of it in terms of the inexistent that comes to produce a new order once it is transcendentally indexed to a two-way world. Like, this is very familiar to STP because it is what you use account of the inexistence, right? So here is the quote, a relevant quote that I used when I found the typo there, inexistential, something from the Portuguese, like the character changed it. Anyway, it is worth dwelling one last time after its conceptual presentation on the signification of this phantom-like element, the proper inexistent of an object. Its inexistence is guaranteed in every object, because the minimum exists in every transcendental, and so true does for every multiple A of the world ontologically conceived, the real atom prescribed. You don't really need to, you know, understand all that. There is a very straightforward and intuitive way to understand. Of course, there is a formal way that gains a lot of, makes it much more find and gains a lot of ways to use it in a certain sense beyond the, you know, informal understanding. But the idea is basically that, you know, in Badiou you have this difference between appearing and being, right? And the way things appear is that they are, in a certain sense, indexed to a world. And world is a word, are multiple worlds. There are multiple worlds. So in a certain sense, there is this difference between ontology and phenomenology. And what phenomenologically appears exists ontologically as a multiple, which is neutral in terms of its appearance or its phenomenological properties, in a certain sense. So there is this concept of something that is part of what appears while not being accounted for in appearance. So for instance, in music it's very easy to think of that. Like I had this nice little dialectics of the uncoded encoding that comes from this, actually comes from Badiou's Spolium on Music, that develops this idea or proposes a version of that idea in terms of a succession of musical examples in a certain sense. So for instance, there is a certain grammar to music, the world of music at a certain point, wherein certain sounds, types of connections, or types of, you know, unfoldings are prohibited or are rare. In either case, they are not dominant in the world, or they are kind of, they could be considered as a part, as unencoded as such, or encoded only as a, you know, as a auxiliary element. So in this little dialectics, for instance, Badiou in his Scolium goes exactly to the musical example and tries to offer an idea of the unfolding of post-tonal music in 20th century out of, you know, a certain already regimented world of tonal music by the end of 19th century, right? So I have this kind of, I'm not sure, maybe I should play a little bit of the examples. The people who seen this class, you should forgive me, because just to make it more, if I'm trying to do an informal and intuitive approach, I think it will help if people listen a little bit to these pieces, just 1 minute of each one, and to understand not only how this unencoded comes to be coded within a certain piece, but also the consequences that this encoding brings to bear on music itself, that makes it makes other unencoded visible. The other unencoded things appear because you coded something that was not part of the world before, right? I'm sure this is getting a little complex, but you can recognize kind of this dynamics between noise and music that Attali is saying, but Attali is not offering really a more specific example. Of course, these examples are the examples that only deal with music in its relationship to its outside, not with political economy as such. This is why it's interesting to see what Attali is doing with the kinds of encoding that comes with exchange abstraction brings to bear on, you know, or is brought to bear on music making. That's what that says. So I'm here. I'm not considering here this political economy aspect, which will be considered afterwards. But here, for instance, let me see if I'm sharing the, just a sec, sharing the sound as well. I think this changed. We'll share screen. Yeah, sorry, I'm getting distracted by the chat. Okay, I found it. Share some, let's see. Okay, so we're back. So for instance, let me start before the examples, like a very kind of straightforward kind of structure of, you know, tonal music. So things are more evident. For instance, this Chopin Prelude, number 7. Maximum tension. And now it's resolving. This is a whole prelude. It's actually two phrases. Like you have an antecedent and a consequent. There is a point of maximum tension in the consequent. And you see they are, you know, they have also very regular sizes, time slices, right? And, you know, tonal music has this kind of correlation between, you know, tension and distension and, you know, the way time unfolds in a very regular kind of rhythmic grid. So in my example, things are not so straightforward. This is getting lost with the things. Okay. For instance, in the beginning, this is the middle of 19th century. In the beginning of 20th century, or the end of 19th century, we have like structures like this. This is Schoenberg's string quartet number 1, which is fairly kind of a continuation of, you know, the language of Mahler and Richard Strauss and this kind of Viennese. And Attali talks a lot about the Viennese kind of, there is a kind of marginality that is aesthetic and political at the same time. I think we had a kind of this discussion with Gabriel before, like what's in the water in Vienna at this point. But anyway, Schoenberg. It's drifting, right? Like, where's the resolution? Farther and farther. Farther and farther. Unexpectedly, after 1 minute of, you know, drift. And it's weird because it resolves one half step, a step, you know, away from the original tonic. So anyway, it actually appears as if it is resolving, but it's not really resolving in the same tonality. I think it's kind of clear that it's very different from, you know, the Chopin example. It's not as regular. You have a lots of dissonance. Things are going weird, and then he goes back home. The point is that he still goes back home. This is tonality. Like you have this affirmation of, you know, a certain central chord, you know, that governs the transcendental degrees, actually, kind of you, what you are distributing in the tones of the music. So there is already kind of irregularity also rhythmically, but then you get to this. This is actually after, you know, the breaking of tonality, which is the second, the emancipation of dissonance. It comes with Schoenberg, but I chose this also a string quartet. I'm trying to keep a certain homogeneity of instrumentation so it gets clearer, right? And there's this string quartet by Webern. Webern is already, this is already atonal, or so-called atonal. say that it is, it has drifted, it is already, you know, in a different space, right? One interesting consequence, just to make sure you get the dialectics of the thing, like once you emancipate dissonance, which is Schoenberg's parlance for, you know, this kind of what he's doing and what Webern is doing in response to him, which means you're not going back home anymore. You're not going back to your tonic anymore or to consonance anymore as governing the discourse. But once you do that, first, phraseology is not the same. Remember the Chopin example, like that's very regular phrases. The phrases are all irregular here. And this kind of liberates time. And also by liberating time, you are liberating the timbral qualities that govern each little amount of musical time, which means you have a rate of time timbral change that is much greater than in tonal music. For instance, going back to the Webern example, just that, like you have three different touches, three different ways of playing the strings. You have like with the arch, dana, and then like a pizzicato, and then you have like a coupe of, you know, the, you know, I'm not sure in English how you say that, like when you beat with the instrument, with the arch. So Botticello. Harmonics. So I just counted like six different ways of playing and six different timbres that comes into like a very, like, what was it? 15 seconds of music. So this is kind of a consequence, because once you don't have this regimented kind of discourse wherein you have to go back to home, you are liberating the rate of change. And by liberating the rate of change, you are kind of emancipating timbre. Timbre is not a way to individuate the singing voice anymore, because you don't have a singing voice, principal singing voice with a specific kind of time organization, right? So this is what I call emancipation of timbre. When you emancipate timbre, you get something like that. Seconds of Barrès's hyperprisme. It is only basically one note with a little, you know, flourish around, like this kind of things. It's one note. The note is, you know, traveling from instrument to instrument, so you get to listen to it in different timbres. At the same time, you have this, you know, activation of noises from the percussion going on all the same at the same time. So there's no phrase, there's no melody, there's no, you know, kind of you know, I have the Portuguese word. Anyway, you don't have this quadratura. How do you say quadratura anymore? Anyway, like this regular organization of, you know, time. So you get to use also different kind of timbres all the time and with a very, very big rate of change. And also you'll get to use noises. And with the emancipation of timbre, you see the interest in using noise, because noise was, you know, not determined frequencies. So it's not, you know, adequate for representing, you know, harmony, tonal harmony. You know, noise usually in tonal music has a supporting role. Like, for instance, you have like the percussion that is supporting, you know, the melody or the harmonies and all that. So here in Baez, you have like this predominance of noise and the idea that the change, the pure change in timbre of the same note is already a certain form of discourse, whereas it wasn't before. So here in the Ionisation, you don't have even the note anymore. It's just, you know, percussive sounds. Get into some art. Just rhythms and noises organized in time. So to get back to our dialectics, like you have like this right, kind of a square kind of language where you have to go back home. There are certain forms of dissonance that are permitted that have to resolve and all of that. And this gives us a certain regular form of time. By the end of 19th century, you are moving forward and forward and forward and delaying going back home, as we saw in the Champagne example. You have this predominant chromaticism, this tendency towards the dissolution of this kind of this discourse, of this organization. And what Schoenberg wanted was the emancipation of dissonance, but what he got was the emancipation of timbre as well. This is kind of what I wanted to say about the kind of the inexistence of the unencoded, because you traversed a certain boundary of tonality, something else appeared, not only the dissonance, but the fact that you are using dissonance the way you are using makes the timbre appear differently. Timbre did not appear in that way before. So you have to take that now into account and organize it. By organizing timbre, noise appears in a way that it didn't appear before. Because if you are organizing, overtly organizing timbre, the difference between sound and noise becomes central. And this difference becomes a structuring difference, whereas it wasn't really a structuring difference. So you have like Vahaz. And if you have this, you may come to the conclusion that, okay, I may use just noise or unpitched sounds that he uses in Ionisation. And then you may come with the right technical inventions to the conclusion that you may as well compose your timbres and your noises, which is what happened with electronic music and Stockhausen in this example. Like 1959, and you know, the first example, the Schoenberg example, is 1907, like 50 years of difference between the first and the last example. Anyway, so what is important to understand here is the fact that these are not, you know, the product of, you know, voluntarism. Is the fact that, for instance, when you break some form of structure, some element appears that didn't appear. Then you have to take into account and come up with a solution for its appearance. And by taking that into account, other consequences follow, other things are appearing. So this is a kind of just a very quick kind of example of what I take to be, for instance, this relationship between music and noise that Attali is talking about. Of course, this is historically situated within the beginning of the 20th century here. But of course, Attali is talking in a trans-historical way So I take it that, for instance, sacrifice is his word for this, but within a certain social formation where this organizing gesture that music performs on a certain material is a symbolic means of, you know, enacting the organization of society in its exchange with a kind of hostile, perhaps, nature, right? You can find echoes of, you know, Adorno here and things like that. So the four modes in Attali, when power wants to make people forget, music is ritual sacrifice, the scapegoat, what I was just saying. When it wants them to believe, music is enactment, representation. When it wants to silence them, it is reproduced, normalized repetition. Thus, it heralds the subversion of both the existing code and the power in the making, well before the latter is in place. This is kind of the foreshadowing thesis that I have a kind of hard time grasping. Today, in embryonic form, beyond repetition lies freedom, more than a new music, a fourth kind of musical practice. It heralds the arrival of new social relations. Music is becoming composition. Representation against fear, repetition against harmony, which is here was kind of the object of sacrifice, right? Then repetition against harmony, which was kind of also the object of representation, composition against normality, which is what, you know, repetition promotes normality. So composition against normality. It is this interplay of concepts as the music invites us to enter in its capacity as the herald of organizations and their overall political strategies. So I'm using this old example that I used a few times in classes and things like that, this sequence, this historical sequence, to make sense, intuitive sense of what he's talking about. Otherwise we are very unsituated in terms of what music is actually able to do, right? Because, you know, usually people have a very kind of limited kind of understanding of what music is able to do. So I think Attali is talking about this relationship with its outside, but also there's this further thesis that this foreshadows forms of the political economy. But I take it that it's not a foreshadowing, it is actually a kind of orientation from the point of view of the political economy and the way the political economy is orienting what is to be indexed within the, you know, music making. For instance, the existence of a word concept that will be the object of copyright laws in order for it to be sold and bought, right? So in a certain sense, there is this also this relationship that is not really a foreshadowing relationship necessarily, right? It's a kind of simultaneous relationship of a kind of different transcendental, a multi-layered world, as we like it, to call it in STP, where you have like this immanent kind of dynamics that I was kind of offering or presenting, and this extrinsic dynamic that comes from, you know, outside the sphere of pure, let us call it, because of lack of good terms for that, a kind of extrinsic relationship to, you know, the political economy that is kind of determining in a certain sense, the shapes that music making will take from a different kind of transcendental, from the transcendental proper to music, right? So then he goes on to describe these four networks that has to do with the role of this, you know, this indexing within the commodity exchange world, let us say. Thus, under the sacrificial codes, music was heard not only at the place of sacrifice, but also at all of the places of daily life and labor where it was present in its ambiguous role as integrator and subverter. This is important because it's also an overlap to our framework, the idea that, you know, mode A has a kind of paraconsistent logic that comes with it. So, you know, the role of the musician, the way he presents it, historically accurate or not, it's kind of akin to the role of the shaman in a certain sense. Like it's part of two different things at the same time. He is and is not part of the same world. He's an integrated and subverted at the same time. This is kind of important, it seems to me. After the economy broke this network down, there came to be new modes of musical distribution, other places for music to be expressed, heard, and exchanged, other networks. These networks changed music. But once again, the essential point is that they heralded a very thoroughgoing change in social organization, a change in the overall mode of economic production. We can distinguish conceptually four essential types of networks and four possible forms of musical distribution, corresponding to the four fundamental structures it is possible to schematize. Each of these networks relate to a technology and a different level of social structuring, a technology and a different level of social structuring. They succeeded and also interpenetrated one another in the economy. So there is a kind of simultaneity. I say that it's much more important than that. Like, you can't really describe repetition without representation, without the other modes at the same time. It's much more like what Caratani says, like you have a dominant mode, like a mode that is in a certain sense the, on the outside organizing, you know, elements that are kind of the remnants of the previous modes in a certain sense. So the first, the three first networks, I'm saving composition to the end. First network is that of sacrificial ritual already described. It is a distributive network for all of the orders, myths, and religious, social, or economic relations of symbolic societies. It is centralized. There's a kind of a storm going on here. It is centralized on the level of ideology and decentralized on the economic level. A new network of music emerges with representation. Music becomes a spectacle attended at specific places, concert halls, the closed space of the simulacrum of ritual, a confinement made necessary by the collection of entrance fees. In this network, the value of music is its use value as spectacle. This new value simulates and replaces the sacrificial value of music in the preceding network. He's very free in his use of value, like the nomenclature of value. But anyway, this new value simulates and replaces the sacrificial value of music in the preceding network. Performers and actors are producers of a special kind who are paid in money by the spectator. We will see that this network characterizes the entire economy of competitive capitalism, the primitive mode of capitalism. The third network, that of repetition, appears at the end of 19th century with the advent of recording. This technology, conceived as a way of story representation, created in 50 years' time with the phonograph record, a new organizational network for the economy of music. In this network, each spectator has a solitary relation with the material object. The consumption of music is individualized, a simulacrum of ritual sacrifice, a blind spectacle. Not sure about this last bit. The network is no longer a form of sociality, an opportunity for spectators to meet and communicate, but rather a tool making the individualized stockpiling of music possible on a huge scale. Here again, the new network first appears in music as a herald of a new stage in the organization of capitalism, that of a repetitive mass production of all social relations. So his antediluvian form is sacrifice. Like, this is trying to make sense of what he talks about sacrifice. Before exchange, we see that music fulfills a very precise function. I would say that's not very precise, but anyway, he says that it's very precise in social organization according to a code I shall call sacrificial. Codification of this kind gives music a meaning, an operationality beyond its own syntax. This is important because one part of the argument is to make sense of Attali, you have to kind of differentiate two levels, right? One level is the one that I was trying to describe with Badiou, like there is a kind of immanent level of, you know, the relationship of music to its materials, to these unencoded materials that are appearing as, you know, you are coming up with consequences for these appearance, for the appearance of the previous unencoded, right? But at the same time, there is this operationality beyond the syntax, the internal syntax of the music, that is kind of this orientation. Not sure if orientation is a good word, but this is also this second form of indexing of this kind of imminent unfolding within the specific mode of exchange that is governing the practice. So there is a kind of there you see a kind of it starts to be thinkable, the relationship between not only the musical synthesis or the sound synthesis, but also the relationship between that and the social synthesis in terms of the social function that the music is enacting in the mode of exchange. All music can be defined as noise given form according to a code, in other words, according to rules of arrangement and laws of succession, in a limited space, a space of sounds that is theoretically knowable by the listener. Listening to music is to receive a message, blah, blah, blah. I don't think we need all of that. But anyway, the sacrifice bit is kind of weird to me because the social nexus is kind of hard to see there. Of course, there are, you know, the anthropological works that, you know, develop this theme of the sacrifice. But to say that music is enacting the same structure because it kind of it is performing an exchange with, I don't know, natural forces or the materials that are not encoded within the musical practice. Of course, there is a kind of very kind of loose, I'd say, homology there. But anyway, this is part of his framework. To be clear, the relationship of music to the inexistent, I find it non-problematic. The problem is to say that this is a kind of the enactment of ritual murder. Like, I think this is kind of overstretching a bit. But then this is the way he's conceptualizing this relationship of music to its inexistent and trying to connect it to social synthesis of a certain form of mode A. I'm not sure if it's successful, but this is the way he does. Methodological question, which I love, this is very important. At what stage in the production of a music work is money produced? Does that stage vary according to the network, and can the rupture of networks be explained by it? This economic problem is a complex one because a musical work, as I was saying, I was mentioning, you know, the ontology and all that, you know, philosophical things that people talk about, the ontology of musical works. This economic problem is a complex one because a musical work is an abstract form produced in several steps, which are structured differently depending on the network within which the work is inscribed. So, of course, the form of what we call a musical work will change with the different social, with the relative importance of each social nexus within this structure that, you know, begets the musical work within the social synthesis as a whole. So this is where, you know, I think the social synthesis is important. First, the composer produces a program, a mold, an abstract algorithm. The score he writes is an order described for an operator interpreter. Then the interpreter creates an order in sound space with his instrument, which is a score translating machine to decipher the coded thought of the composer. The form of the music is always influenced by the transmitter and the medium. Finally, the object is produced, sold, consumed, destroyed, worn out. This involves a whole gamut of commodity production from the score to the record. We will see that demand begins to require labor. It has to be socially produced. That this is one of the theses about repetition. Like in representation, you have like this bourgeois culture of attending concerts, and this is a mark of kind of a social distinction. People want to go to the representation, to the spectacle, because it's differentiate them from, you know, the rabble, I don't know. Whereas in repetition, you have to socially produce the demand, which is a part of his argument about the difference between, you know, representation that has, you know, the printed score as dominant. There is this nexus given by the existence of a printed score that we call a musical work, that you go and see it enacted once or once in a while, perhaps. And repetition, which is the dissemination of copies, recorded copies of that. And a kind of also an overproduction, kind of practice of overproduction, but that you have to counter by creating demand for that overproduction in a certain sense. And this is the function of the hit parade. I like this part of the book. I'm not sure if it's sound, but it's funny. But let's go there. On the methodological question, this is me. In a sense, after the advent of exchange value in representation, the relationship between noise and code is not directly social. In the Marxist sense, it is exactly social, but anyway. But let us not talk in the, you know, in the jargon, but mediated by the indexing of noise into what is marketable as music, which means it has to be indexed in the logic of commodity exchange as well, not only in the immanent logic of music. The work concept provides an object for the copyright laws that would enable making a profit out of the work of musicians. But then the question becomes, what is the social nexus that produces value in music making? Is it the composer, composition, the performer or performance? Is it the printed score or the printers, the company, the printed score? These are, you know, the owners of copyright, copyrights of the score. The fact one has to create a boundary between what counts and what doesn't makes representation a case of mode being dominant. While in repetition, the emancipation of the recorded object dissolves the boundary, making it a purer example of mode C. So how the economy functions for each network? In the sacrificial network, music does not create wealth. The distinction between the productive and the unproductive is not even relevant to the shaman or nor to the jongleur later on. The minstrel, for his part, was unproductive, as has been most of the work of musicians like Wagner and Boulez up to the present day. The accumulation of wealth through music appears only with representation, which both creates value and is the mode of functioning of the decline of the religious. In this network, value is created and accumulated outside the control of the composing musician. Marx himself provides a good analysis of the site of the creation of value in this network. A singer who sings like a bird is an unproductive worker. When she sells her song, she is a wage earner or merchant. But the same singer employed by someone else to give concerts and bring in money is a productive worker because she directly produced capital. So he's using here Marx's idea of who is producing surplus value and who is therefore the productive worker here. So this makes the composer a weird kind of to have a weird position in this, because the composer is a rentier, right? Therefore, the productive workers who create money are the performers and the people who produce the instruments and the scores. But when the composer receives royalties on a work of his that is sold and represented, he remains curiously estranged from the wealth associated with him, since as an independent craftsman, he is outside the capitalist mode of production. This will be kind of important to, you know, the Gato Tosco, the clumsy cat. This is why this is kind of part of the relationship between the two texts. How the economy functions, I'm still in the same subject. Generally remunerated with a percentage of a surplus value obtained from the sale of a commercial object, the score, and its use, the performance, is reproduced in every copy of the score and in each performance by virtue of the royalty laws. His remuneration is therefore a kind of rent, strange situation. A category of workers has thus succeeded in preserving ownership of their labor, in avoiding the position of wage earner, in being remunerated as a rentier, who dips into the surplus value produced by wage earners who valorize their labor in the commodity cycle. As a creator of the program that all of the capitalist production plugs into, he belongs to a more general category of people whom I shall call molders, those who make the mold, right? Entertainment entrepreneurs are capitalists. Workers in publishing and performance are productive workers. Composers are rentiers. This situation is not without significance. It is even essential in understanding both the uniqueness of music and its prophetic nature in economic imitations. So repetition of the molders. If we go by the preceding analysis, a person whose creation originates in an extensive process of material production is remunerated as a rentier. His income is independent of the quantity of labor he provides. Instead, it depends on the quantity of demand for that labor. He produces the mold from which an industry is built. Here in repetition, right? He argues that in representation, you still have a make-believe kind of, you know, labor theory of value in music. But since you are not comparing amounts of labor that goes into producing musical works, you have a standard, and this is also an interesting thing. You can derive the function of genre in a certain sense in music, because then you can price, you know, opera, symphony, quartets, whatever, as standards, not as, you know, real measures of the amount of work that come into the making of a score or something like that. But then there's this make-believe thing that goes through the standard in valorizing the musical work, which will price the, you know, you will give a price to the commissions, what kind of commissions you are making, is a commission of our symphony and opera, whatever, chamber work, whatever. So there exists in the economy a considerable number of program producers, motors. In representation, handicrafts, or archaic capitalism, each object is unique. There will be another. And the mold is used only once. By contrast, in the economy of repetition, a mold is used a great many times. If the remuneration of a motor is proportional to the number of sales and not to the duration of his labor, because it will be used many times, right? Then he can collect a rent and reduce the capitalist profit. That is why it is in the interest of the capitalist process to incorporate molders as wage earners. Yeah. Anyway, I have my issues with that. But anyway, we can discuss that. Stated very simply, representation in the system of commerce is that which arises from a singular act. Repetition is that which is mass produced. The concert is representation, but also a meal à la carte in a restaurant. A phonograph record or a can of food is repetition. Other examples of representation are a custom-made piece of furniture or a tailored dress, and of repetition, ready-made clothing and mass-produced furniture. One provides a use value tied to the human quality of the production. The other allows for stockpiling, easy accessibility, and repetition. I like this idea that, you know, you're paying for accessibility, because the book was written in 1977, and now you have like this, all this, you know, platform economy, which is, you know, you're paying for accessibility in a certain sense, like, and stockpiling. The difference is that you are not stockpiling your records. Your records are stockpiled elsewhere, and you pay for the accessibility to the records. This is also one interesting thesis that he has about, you know, repetition. The fact that you are spending your exchange time, which is the time you spend gathering the money to buy the records in order to stockpile your use time, because you're not listening to the records, you only have the records. So you are collecting the records for a future point in time to listen to them. So this, there's this idea of stockpiling use time that comes in repetition. So in repetition, a work is generally heard only once. It is a unique moment in representation. In repetition, potential hearings are stockpiled. Potential hearings are stockpiled, exactly what I was saying. These four kinds of modes of production interpenetrate in time and space, but it still seems possible to discern a certain economic logic of succession. In music, as in the rest of the economy, the logic of the succession of musical codes parallel the logic of the creation of value. It's interesting because it says parallels here. It's not saying foreshadowing. So for me, it's ambiguous. Why is it that it says that he's always foreshadowing the, you know, the economy? Because supposedly one of the arguments is, you know, to change things in music or in code management is faster than changing things in the real world, in the relationship between, you know, people and all that, in the real economy. But this is very weak, right? So anyway, and you can't really state this as a matter of fact, it seems. So maybe I have to go faster a little bit. So creating the demand, in the case of semi-identical objects selling for the same price and arriving on the market in quantities so high that radio programmers, let alone the consumer, cannot test them all. Differentiation requires a ranking scheme. This is interesting. A ranking scheme exterior to the production, one recognized as legitimate by the consumers and capable of defining for them the use value of the title. For the use value of a song is not only reflected, but also created by its place on the hit parade. Like, this is 1977, like, you can think that hit parade like was an important thing, but I kind of lived a very similar thing in the underground kind of, you know, ecosystem that I'm part of, noise making and this kind of thing, with, you know, the yearly lists, like, what's your favorite records of, you know, I always found that abominable, never wanted to take part on that, because it's kind of, you are deciding what is, you know, what is valuable within 1 year of production, that you're, of course, never listen to everything and all of that. So anyway, I don't like this kind of manipulation of what, creation of difference in the undifferentiated, and it is undifferentiated because there is a lot of production, so you can't really listen to it all. So this is a problem, really. Anyway, maybe a problem without solution, but anyway, I never wanted to engage in that kind of list making and this kind of thing. So it's kind of identical to the hit parade, a title that no longer ranks, has no use value. It is therefore essential that the consumer believe in the legitimacy of his hierarchy, which reflects and creates value. There is a kind of, also a kind of dark hypothesis that having a label, like I have one, is basically engaging in a hit parade. Like, this is a very dark hypothesis that, you know, I was thinking of, because everybody can, you know, upload their music nowadays, and still they want me to, you know, put their records out. Why is it that? Because they want the validation of the hit parade that is, you know, Seminole Records catalog, something like that. So this is kind of weird. Thus, the hit parade system advertises the fact that the value of an object depends on the existence of other alternate objects and disappears when the possibility of making more surplus value with other object arises. An object's value is a function of the intensity of the financial pressures of the new titles waiting to enter circulation. Exchange thus completes the destruction of any fiction of autonomous stable use value. Usage is no longer anything more than the public display of the velocity of exchange. I do not mean to say that the hit parade creates the sales, but much more subtly, that it channels, selects, and gives a value to things that would otherwise have none, that would float undifferentiated. So the modes and their logic, this is me. Sacrifice noises the unwanted, and at the same time, that which is organized into an acceptable form. The musician has the status of sacrificer by bringing order into chaos, while at the same time being a marginalized class. So he's in the paraconsistent position, paraconsistent logic, as we were talking about in Caratani, not in Attali. Representation, by encoding noise in harmony, representation takes an ideological form. Like representation has a musical syntax, the syntax of tonality, harmonic music. The ticket payment establishes a frontier between inside and outside. The commoditization of music under representation first takes the form of mode B. It establishes a logic of contracts, both as a means of entrance into the concert hall and as the way the tonal system regiments dissonance under determined rules. So classical logic, as we say, also in mode B, in Caratani's mode B, the mode of the state and, you know, contracts and laws and everything. Repetition, by dislodging the place of representation, repetition generalized the codes in the form of the production of replicas. These are literal replicas, recordings of the same content, and metaphorical replicas in the sense of having a very simplified musical syntax being adopted. He has his, also this much weirder kind of argument about musical language in repetition that has to do, there's this dual kind of thing. One side is, you know, in culture industry, you know, song forms, and because you don't have the time to, you know, actually engage in the use time of the, you know, things that you are purchasing, there is a valorization of shorter musical forms and simplified musical forms. Now there's kind of an economic kind of, which is kind of interesting, an economic argument about musical syntax in repetition. At the same time, there is this kind of negation of that in, you know, academic contemporary music. But Attali says that they share kind of the same values, because in academic contemporary music, there is also this appeal to scientific abstraction in the organization of sounds, that in a certain sense is also a way for the elite to believe they have the control over, you know, the reproductive mode, which is weird, because I don't think, you know, contemporary concert music is really elitist, because, you know, the elite is not consuming that. It's maybe a branch of, you know, state power that is invested in research. But is this an elite in the economic sense? I'm not sure. I think there's a hole there in the argument. He's looking at these two things, and actually there is this middle ground that's covered by free jazz, this kind of thing, which is what I usually call the underground or noise or these kind of things, noise in the, as a genre, which prefigures composition. We'll get to that right after this. So with this comes the end of the limits that were proper to representation. Differences are produced within the field as a production of demand, hit parade, etc. While it all tends to non-differentiation, differentiation is continually produced between the more and the less important. Exchange time is spent for stockpiling used time that doesn't get used. The necessity of the creation of differentiator entails a dense scheme of values. This is a term by Nelson Goodman. This is very tentative of me, of course. For any values x and y, where y is greater than x, a third value between them is envisageable. So it's a dense scheme in a certain sense. So far, it's an intuitionistic logic of value that we also usually connect to mode C. So beyond the three modes, the fourth mode, composition, this is Attali. Finally, you can envision one last network beyond exchange in which music could be lived as composition. In other words, in which it would be performed for the musician's own enjoyment, as self-communication, with no other goal than his own pleasure, as something fundamentally outside all communication, as self-transcendent, a solitary, egotistical, non-commercial act. Maybe Corey, who's here, might remember Brand, Harry Flint's Brand in this network, what is heard by others would be a byproduct of what the composer or interpreter wrote or performed for the sake of hearing it, just as a book is never more than a byproduct of what the writer wrote for the sake of writing it. At the extreme, music would no longer be made to be heard, but to be seen in order to prevent the composition from being limited by the interpretation. What's going on? There's a problem there. Maybe I made a mistake in when I copied the text, sorry. I'm skipping that phrase, that's a weird phrase. This composition proposes a radical social model, one in which the body is treated as capable not only of production and consumption, and even of entry into relations with others, but also of autonomous pleasure. This network differs from all those preceding it. This capacity for personal transcendence is excluded from all other musical networks. I think this is all very strong, like a strong statement. Anyway, in a society of ritualized sacrifice, representational speech, or hierarchical repetitive communication, egotistical pleasure is repressed, and music has value only when it is synonymous with sociality, performance for an audience, or finally the stockpiling of beauty for solid consumers. I think it's very strange because the stockpiling is already kind of this kind of individualized kind of relationship to the product. But when these modes of communication collapse, all that is left for the musician is self-communication. Here again, this network is ahead of its time and precedes a general evolution of social organization as a whole. Like there is a kind of a logical leap there, because from this individualized or atomized kind of relationship to music, a general evolution of social organization as a whole will come about. I'm not sure about that. Yeah, maybe because it's unavoidable, right? But is it the general social organization that is desirable as composition? I'm not sure. So my question is, composition to be understood as closer to Cayetani's mode D, like free associationism, there's kind of a certain ring to it, or STP's Communist hypothesis, because he mentions the coming about of a social organization that is not part of the dominant mode of exchange, right? Even though the way he portrays it is this kind of individual enjoyment. So it's kind of interesting. There's a bunch of different components to the question. So what is Cayetani's fourth mode? Mode D should be treated separately from the other three for two reasons. First of all, because it serves a more prescriptive function in this theoretical apparatus. Cayetani uses the idea of a mode of intercourse based on free association and the mutuality of freedom to reconstruct a silent history of socialist impetus that would bring together nomadic lifestyles, the sense of justice of world religions, secular philosophical ethics, and modern socialism. Furthermore, by defending the transcendental status of this fourth mode, he's able to propose a coherent description of a possible socialist world where mode D would be dominant over all others, making it consistent with this general theory of modes and their articulation. As interesting as this construction might be, the value of this approach to communist politics is limited, since analytically This additional mode plays no determinant part in defining different social formations in his theory, to the point that mode D is not even included in his theory of the articulations of mode A, B, and C in capitalism. Due to his conceptual fragility, and because he will propose here an alternative approach to communist social forms, will not rely on the hypothesis of his fourth mode of intercourse. So therefore, we have like this communist hypothesis that says that the space of total organization is bigger than the space of capitalist organizations, right? So it's a kind of way of situating the practical side of, you know, this experimentation towards this different mode that is not a, either A, B, or C, or maybe it's a specific kind of recipe mixture between these modes. So this is mildly important because of Clumsy Cat. From the moment there was sacrificial ritual coded independently of the musician lost possession of music. Music then had a goal exterior to the pleasure of its producer, unless he could find pleasure, as is the case of in repetition, in his very alienation, in being plugged into codes external to his work, or in his personal recreation of a pre-established score. Exteriority can only disappear in composition. I really don't like this idea, but anyway, I'm a, you know, pro-mediation guy, not a, you know, the end of exteriority, of alienation. I really don't think this is tenable. But in which the musician plays primarily for himself outside any operationality, spectacle, or accumulation of value. When music, extricating itself from the codes of sacrifice, representation, repetition, emerges as an activity that is an end in itself. So the kingdom of ends, in a certain sense, that, you know, Caratani wanted, that created from Kant, that created its own code at the same time as the work. Composition thus appears as a negation of the division of roles. This is the important bit to me. Negation of the division of roles and labor as constructed by the old codes. Therefore, in the final analysis, to listen to music in the network of composition is to rewrite it, to put music into operation, to draw it toward an unknown praxis. I have a hard time kind of, you know, making consistent the idea that you have like something for yourself at the same time that this will constitute a new social synthesis. Of course, you don't need to intend the social nexus, but anyway, it's unclear. It's more that it is unclear how this come about, right? Listening is the operator, composition then beyond the realm of music, calls into question the distinction between worker and consumer, between doing and destroying, a fundamental division of roles in all societies in which usage is defined by a code. To compose is to take pleasure in the instruments, the tools of communication, in use, time, and exchange them as lived and no longer as stockpiled. There's a lot of things mixed in that I'm not really certain about, but at the same time, there is a kind of interesting thing that will be clear perhaps later. I'm getting to the end. Sorry, this is way too, this got out of hand. Like, it's very, very long now. So the Châtelet says, and Wilkins is rehearsing Châtelet here, says that this is a neoliberal thing, whatever. Despite the rhetoric of radical emancipatory politics, Attali's noise should be read as an anarcho-mercantilist endorsement rather than a critique of political economy, in the sense that, like the classical and neoclassical theorists before him, he considers that a beneficial world will emerge from the creative noise composed by the aggregate effect of social behavior if only it is let be. Certain telling remarks reveal the putrefaction of liberationist ideas that lies behind his discourse. For example, he claims that utopian overcoming of alienation, which he locates in usage rather than production, prophesied by music requires a renunciation of all goals in favor of an aimless compositional twiddling, a doing for the sake of doing, leading to a reconciliation between work and play. I really don't understand. Also, as much as I have my own critiques of, you know, Attali, I really don't understand Châtelet's critique here. I think Moscardi likes Châtelet after and explain to me what's really the issue. There is, of course, an epistemological issue because Châtelet is kind of also like Renaton is polemizing against, you know, the order from chaos crowd. And but yeah, I read that book, that To Think and Live Like Pigs. I really don't see it. Sorry. So, a case study, Cajun Cardio, like this will be quicker. Page has a place of honor in Natalie's account of the superation of superseding, sorry, of repetition. This was kind of a false covenant. This is easy to understand as Cage is challenging the place of repetition as he challenges the word concept and the technical reproduction of his proposals. While this may suggest a prefiguration of composition in Attali's sense of a practice non-socially validated, there's more to be said about indeterminate scores and their specific ways they enact sociality in their realization. This is a quote from Benjamin Pikott. He writes this essay about this disastrous performance of Atlas Ecliticalis, this piece by Cage, in 1964 by the New York Philharmonic. The ensuing disastrous performance of Atlas Ecliticalis has become a minor legend for those interested in Cage's life and work. In an interview 20 years later, Cage did not mince words when it came to describing the Philharmonic. They're a group of gangsters. They do everything wrong on purpose. Not to make fun of something, but to ruin it. They get in mind criminal ideas, artistically criminal ideas. They are vandals. The moment they can ruin a piece, they are delighted. They also have tenure. Wow. Yeah, this is starting to see, be very familiar. You can't throw them out. Their job is secure. Therefore, they can act any way they like. They're not like children. The LA Orchestra is like children. Well, LA is like children, New York, no, it's not like children. The New York Orchestra is like grown-ups who intend to be bad. They are criminals. Like, this is ridiculous, right? But anyway, it's just that there's this rhetoric that, you know, the New York Philharmonic, they were kind of making fun of the freedom that Cage was giving them in his music, like in Atlas Ecliticalis. The score looks like that, like there's a bunch of, you know, drawings and notes. These are taken out of an atlas and a star map, right? And the shape of the constellations like give these different shapes in the score. Each musician plays uncoordinated to other musicians. And of course, you don't read each figure from, you know, from left to right. Actually, some, you know, vertical figures, you can read the notes that are part of these vertical figures in any order, right? And then there's the kind of cyclical figures that you can start from any point and complete the cycle before you start again. So there's all these micro temporalities. Each musician is going independently of others. You know, the social synthesis is by accident. This is interesting because, you know, the social synthesis is actually the respect. It's weird because this nobody says that, you know. Sorry if I'm immodest, but nobody talks about, you know, the fact that, you know, Cajun indeterminacy is actually pretty determinate. I wrote a whole thesis on that. The fact is that the social synthesis is performed at the level of respect to the score, which is pretty much what happened before, like in the 19th century. The score had different rules though. And you are not coordinating your sounds with the sounds of everybody else. You are playing at your leisure. And the synthesis, not the social things, the synthesis, but the synthesis of the result, the sounding result is by chance. Nobody can predict what's going on because everybody can, you know, rearrange the order of the score at their leisure. At the same time, Cage proposed to use like a mixing table, like a mixer in that performance. And like, it was like 89 musicians or something like that. They were plugged into the mixer and there were a transfer procedure to determine which channels would be sounding and which would not be sounding. Therefore, the individual musician does not know when he will listen to his own sound, even if he's playing. So in Cajun ideology saying, oh, there's all this freedom. Like, this is not freedom. Like, this is kind of exactly alienation from the, you know, from your productive labor. Like, the musician produces a sound. He's trying to master his own sound. what Cage is introducing here is a stranger. Like he's not able to listen to his sound or to control the way his sound performs the sound synthesis with the sounds of everybody else. So it is a kind of anatomized kind of sociality. Of course, there is this idea that this will produce a result that imitates nature in its manner of operation. So nature in its manner of operation for Cage is characterized by interpenetration without obstruction. This is kind of the core idea. So things interpenetrate, but they do not obstruct, and they don't have really a connection or inferential or causal connection to each other. They are kind of dislocated from one another, but they are interpenetrate because they are simultaneous. So you have something that is looks like composition in terms of what Attali is saying. Like it's not really for your pleasure, though, but the final result is a kind of atomized sociality. But at the same time, it is perceived by the individual musician as estrangement, as alienation. Like, what the fuck is going on with my sound? I can't recognize my sound, the sound that I'm making and I'm trained to do, and which is my freedom to do. My freedom, not freedom from, but freedom to do, right? So this is I'm pretty critical. This is from a Twitter conversation with Ellie. I think Ellie is there. So in this essay, Piecott remembers the canonical account of what happened in that performance, which is that the traditional orchestral player is not prepared for the freedom that Cage wants them to have. And because of that, they rioted against the piece. But the problem is that in a sense, what Cage asks for is a negation of what they perceive as their freedom. In Atlas and Criticalis, they're supposed to play individual parts uncoordinated to each other. In the New York Philharmonic's performance, a soundboard was used to amplify specific moments, individual instruments, the determination of which and at which moment done through chance procedures. The picture that results is one where you never know when you will actually be listened to within the mass of instruments, and you don't really know how your individual sound composes with other instruments. I think a very powerful argument against this account is that the musician's freedom is predicated on control over the sound. They spend a great deal of time attending the control and the control over how one sound composes with the others. I use the phrase compose. In that sense, we are talking here of a concept of positive freedom, freedom to, against Cage's concept of negative freedom, freedom from. Cage liberates the musician from the tyranny of the result, but subjugates her to the shackles of opacity. You are free from something, but not free to do what you are committed to do. If you compare this, for instance, with Cardio, who also wrote Indeterminate Music, the difference is clear. In Treatise, Cardio offers a graphic score with no instructions, the point of which is that a musician ought to come up with an interpretation of that score. Compare the two cases in terms of social synthesis. In Cage, an atomized set of individuals follow rules that result in something opaque to their efforts. In Cardio, a group of musicians must collaborate to come up with a coherent interpretation of a non-interpreted system of signs. While both are indeterminate scores, the way indeterminacy is acting results in very different outcomes in terms of the sociality created within the space of the music, in a certain sense, right? So I like, more than Treatise, I like The Great Learning. The Great Learning is a masterpiece. And this is paragraph 7. The Great Learning is the 7 paragraphs that correspond to the part called The Great Learning in, the Confucian Analects. It's not really by Confucius, but anyway, who knows what's by Confucius. Each piece is a paragraph. Of course, they are called paragraph 1 to 7, but each are a different piece. So the piece, each piece reflects the content of the text within a certain form of social synthesis. This is why I think it's a masterpiece. And this is before, those who know a little bit of Cardio, Cardio is famous for writing, you know, Stockhausen Serves Imperialism, being like a Marxist-Leninist in England in the 70s. But The Great Learning is before his radicalization, political radicalization. But I do think this is the most politically interesting, informed piece that he wrote. After that, he lapsed back onto representation in a certain sense. He was doing like little songs like smash, smash, smash the social contract for them to be listened to or watched, whereas The Great Learning is to be played. of course, you can have an audience. And I listen to the great learning quite a lot, but I listen from the point of view of somebody who understands what is being done by the piece and by the people who are engaged in doing it. And the great learning also is a piece for non-professional musicians. So the difference between, you know, the professional artist and the non-professional artist is brought into question as well. So there's a lot of interesting things there. And the rules, for instance, for paragraph 7, you sing each word of this paragraph. If the root be in confusion, nothing will be well governed. Of course, the text is reactionary. And then, you know, Cardi repudiated the text. He was trying at some point to revise it and come up with a version with Maoist text. But anyway, this was not successful. But anyway, even if the text is somewhat reactionary, the fact that he's basing a certain process on the content of the text, and the content of the text governs, in a certain sense, he's trying to translate the content of the text to a certain form of relationship between people, and these people includes non-professional musicians. In his text, for instance, if the root be in confusion, you start singing, everybody sings any note, so you have like this cluster of, you know, unintentional from the point of view of a composer, right? Like unintended notes. Of course, they are intended by the singer, individual singer. And as the piece progresses, you listen to your neighbor, and they are. It's also to be sung in movement. Everybody's moving, and sometimes you cross with somebody else, and you try to pick up their note. This is the main order. So the root starts in confusion and they get ordered. So the tendency is towards a unison. It starts with a big cluster, and then you have this beautiful kind of process that ends up in a unison, which is the enactment of kind of the content of the text in a certain sense. So why is it that I don't think this is reactionary in the last instance? It's because it's not in representation. It's not in repetition. It is actually an example. This is why I called it a case study. It's kind of an example of, you know, a certain form of social synthesis governing the sound result, which was the problem that I was putting forward in the beginning of the presentation, right? Like that the intrinsic musical dialectics and the relationship of that dialectics to the social synthesis, right? Of course, money does not get into the picture here right now, because there's no demand for this, for such a thing. There's this other, I'm way, you know, late, so I'm not talking about this. Of course, this is familiar for you guys. I just wanted to say that, you know, the political, perhaps, purchase of the social synthesis that is connecting also to the sounding result is the fact that you are enacting a certain rule and performing a certain sociality. And this sociality is an active sociality of those that are engaged, professionals and non-professionals, in a certain form of music making. So, of course, this is still in the realm of aesthetics, but then you have to think of it as connected to a certain political ecology. And then you are able to come up with maybe a relationship between a certain form of art practice that cannot be directly politicized, but it is politicized to the extent that it communicates with the non-professional side of what you are doing. So it performs a certain form of social synthesis beyond the individual work. I'm using, like, in my case study, individual works, because I wanted to see and to illustrate how possible social synthesis might come about through the norms that govern a certain specific work. But then you have also this constellation of works that is a certain form of genre, a certain form of scene, and a certain form of organization of scene that would create the demand, which is not a commercial demand necessarily, for these kind of works. And this is this creation of a certain demand, which is a part of repetition, according to Attali, that might get, you know, repurposed within modes D or composition are org bigger than K, is the subject of this, you know, paragraph of Marx that incidentally I took from a text by the CSII at the time I was writing with Bruno Trochmann, the Clumsy Cat text, which is a popular text. Of course, it's not really a rigorous academic, you know, philosophical text, a popular text. It's kind of a manifesto. And it was intended to be a popular text. And of course, Gabriel used it again in his last text in Sublation, the same Marx paragraph, if I'm not mistaken. I think it's the same. When communist workmen gather together, their immediate aim is instruction, propaganda, etc. But at the same time, they acquire a new need, the need for society. And what appears as a means had become an end. This practical development can be most strikingly observed in the gathering of French socialist workers. Smoking, eating, and drinking, etc. are no longer means of creating links between people. Company, association, conversation, which in turn has society as its goal, is enough for them. The brotherhood of man is not a hollow phrase, it is a reality, and the nobility of man shines forth upon us from the work-worn figures. This reversal between means and ends, which was the subject of the CSII text, what was it called? The organization, something of, yeah, I don't know. Maybe Gabriel remembers it. It's in Lavra Palavra, I think, which happens when the gathering.
The end of organization.
The end of organization, yeah. Which happens when the gatherings and their organization as means for the revolution become an end in itself, while being criticized by some as a deactivation of a revolutionary impulse, does not exhibit fraternization as a solution and posterior deactivation of demands for emancipation. Instead, it is envisaged as a place where the lack of this association, pleasure, entertainment becomes visible to everyone. In artistic practice, this lack finds a possible fulfillment, a lack that is not of free time, determined by the limits of working hours, but of liberated time, a life that, having its existence acknowledged, can be motivating for the exercise of social transformation. The artist works for wages in order to have free time. The artist, I'm thematizing here the failed artist. I'm proud to be an artist of failure. Me and Bruno, we are talking about the artists of failure, which are the people who does not make a living out of art. So the artist, the failed artist, or the artist of failure works for wages because they have to sell your labor force in order to have free time for art, and makes art in order to one day free herself from work time, because the artists that we are still need to sell their labor power in the market. We're also workers, and the demand for the continuation of what is most dear to us, the art we make, participates in the same set of demands that make us sell our labor power. To think of the two sides of our lives, that of the artist and that of the worker, as separate is to misunderstand how they relate and how the artistic demands put pressure on political action in favor of its continuity. In both ways, the fact that there is an internal disjunction in our life as a worker and artist shows a horizon of possible demands, that of liberated time that is identifiable with the pursuit of the commons. This horizon is only present through the awareness of a need, which is not simply a need that exists, although we do not know it, but the need that is felt as a need when we have the taste of the freedom allowed by free time. The constitution, yeah, and here's the problem of the direct politicization of the artist, since the professional artist has not the same position in the totality as the worker has, which is a problem that in the text we mentioned. This art critic Ben Davis has some very interesting points about this issue. So we were trying to kind of compose, really, like, and try to see the moment of that Marx says, this moment of conviviality and of liberated time. That is the moment that we are doing this kind of independent art making. That is something that that happens in our scenes, in this underground kind of community. And the way that I talk from experience, the way these, in a certain sense, you do a noise concert, and the next week, somebody who had never heard of noise, they are doing their own noise project. So this was very interesting to me. Of course, it is a kind of a closed loop. It's not necessarily giving us very relevant political consequences, but there is a nexus there that in a certain sense integrates this idea of, you know, working for your own pleasure within the necessity for organizing for you to have this time of working for your own pleasure. So the constitution of the artist worker composition is the constitution of the autonomous organization, where the imperatives and demands of for survival temporarily suspended. The organization is the work and the theory and the pleasure and the experience. The time for the construction of the future is the free time that becomes liberated time, but free time only becomes released through the mediation of material conditions. The material conditions change through the mediation of mediations. The map of this transformation can only be collected through the exercise of the organization itself. So this is an attempt to bring it all together, mode D, composition, part bigger than K. Not sure, this is not really precise, but I think Clumsy Cat was onto something. So I'll end there. I'm tired. Any questions?
I have one of those annoying conference questions, which is actually a commentary, but it becomes again a question in the middle of it. Just because I think we have actually as good at Muscardi's here, because, you know, it's a pity that Fernanda left, because it has to do with both things that they are working on. But I think we have a good clue on how to deal with Attali's weird thesis about the foreshadowing of music with regards to social structures. And I also think that, I mean, the presentation was really, really great, but one thing that I think is particularly good is that I think that by moving away from a field that is so messy, because we're doing often, like if you take Karatan, you're doing social political history and you also want to tie it to your politics. So it's hard to know where one thing starts and the other ends, where you're being just empirical objective about it and when you're actually pushing things towards what you want. And with music, that distinction is a bit better because it's harder to make like a bold claim that Karatani would make that, you know, ultimately politics is the fourth mode of organization. And you're like, okay, cool. So, and if you say this now, like, and so music is the new form of social, I say like, yeah, I mean, cheap, you know? So it becomes clearer some strategy. So with that in mind, while you were finishing the presentation, I had an idea. That's why I mentioned Moscardi and Fernanda. Just wanted to share my screen real quick. Just, so I wanted to see what you think of this as a proposal. Because, you know, like one thing that we did in the Atlas, we didn't really explore it much yet, is this idea that, the reason why we focused on modes of intercourse rather than modes of exchange, because the word exchange, it tends to be a bit human-centric, and it seems like it's only about people relating to people, but it's clear in Karatani that it's not meant to describe that, it's meant to describe all types of relations with absolutely no defined extension. So if people start relating as if it's always a relation of I and a thou, to use like the Buber terms, that means you're going to apply it everywhere, including to birds, clouds, planets, until told otherwise, right? So that extends to nature. And we started asking the question, this was something Moscardi worked on. But what is then the social theory of nature for each mode? And we realized that there is kind of a nice distinction where, which is often not made, between nature as a partner, in the sense that nature is an agent you're in dialogue with, nature as a resource. For example, when you're discussing like James Scott's work on states and you see what it means to like manage a forest, you're not looking as a statesman, as a bureaucrat, you're not looking at the forest as a amorphous material. You're looking at it as something which has the properties of trees, and you want to extract those resources which are preformed. There are forms in the forest and you want them for you, but you kind of know what they are. which is different from how capitalism works. Capitalism doesn't give a shit about resources. It cares about the fact that resources are ultimately made of materials, and you can always decompose some resource into some other resource, because those shapes are just provisory. Through chemistry, whatever technologies you can find, that trees are actually better used at that particular moment as, you know, the basis for an oil. So that's what you're going to use. And if at some other point it's like really good for being burned at, you know, some specific party type thing, you're going to do that. So there's no particular thing you're hoarding or enclosing. There's no resource as a definitive trait. There is a material thing. And it's nice to look at this because Attali's claim that there's some prefiguration, foreshadowing in terms of music. Well, you can just look at the question, okay, in a certain sense, sound is a very low cost thing, right? So in a certain sense, you can kind of get, and you can apply our hypothesis about different logics to different kind of forms that sound can take, and you will get kind of what he thinks is the main, let's say, being of music in a given formation. So if sound has a logic of a partner, almost as if you can play off an echo, and an echo is an agent, right? If you can talk in the language of it does something to you, that's pretty much the language in which you're treating sound as something that keeps producers and consumers together. It's performance, it's ritual, okay, but I mean, you don't need to be so, you know, exotic about it. Like, it's just the situation where something is made which is outside of you, but because of that very reason is inside of you. For example, loudness, which is something that makes that particular boundary very troubling. You cannot really tell if it's outside or inside, and making that kind of mixture is part of what makes the component of, is it loud enough, relevant, right? Clearly is part of what makes this sort of thing, this sort of dimension of sound, let's say the being of sound in this social logic, right? Whereas being able to notate something properly, which is very classical in the sense not only of, you know, if you write a note in a notation, it's that note, it's not another note. You can try to do something new with this, but you're going to always get kind of faced with that limit, which also facilitates things being treated as properties, right? It also plays on the fact that sound becomes a resource. That's why the harmonical scale, which is the form inside of sound, it becomes relevant. So to enclose the harmonic scale, right? The harmonic series from inside the sound, that becomes relevant to this particular shape that nature takes under classical logic, which is state form, right? So you can take Attali's idea out of this more, how is it performed and socially used, actually straight to the phenomenology of sound. And I think the same goes for intuitionist idea, which, I mean, when we talk about, you know, there's some type of continuum to sound, and then you need to discretize it and kind of work through liminality, but also work through timbre and all those things. What you're actually doing is focusing on the matter, removing forms, making forms a matter of pragmatic distinction. And if you want to kind of enclose that, you now need a recording, because you cannot trust performers nor notation to have the logic that you're looking for, which is intuitionistic or paracomplete. So in a certain sense, we can actually take this all the way to the phenomenology of sound in a given historical moment. And you can make this very complicated, because clearly you can have music which goes between performance and the ephemeral sound, which is intuitionistic and bypasses notation. You can have music that is more in between these two here, like concert hall, right? You can have music that is more here, where I would put like a certain type of use of electronic music. It's closer to notation, it's more classical in a certain sense, depending on how crucial it is. So you can actually go very far with this and with the ways you combine it. And what is, I think you could say, okay, but then what is mode D? And I mean, I think it's kind of stupid. It's just, you know, if you take musical form to be the most relevant thing, you're not just blindly following a logic and applying to sound that is if it's always that form, because socially that's what's dominating. If the social form needs to recede and give space to whatever the fuck you want to do musically, then that's the logic that you're following, right? So here is where Caratani would put like politics, and we would put like some new universal kind of idea of how to bind things together in the world. Whereas when you're discussing specifically the problem at the level of music, I mean, why would you want to have to consider sound primarily as, you know, an agent, a resource, or a matter? You should be able to choose this according to whatever the hell you're doing, right? Why would you have to necessarily commit to existence being given by performance, notation, or recording, or, you know, execution? Well, that depends on whatever the musical work is, right? So I think it becomes clearer from this perspective that there is some weird kind of delinking here, which we are trying to conceptualize at the level of politics. But I think without this detour, it was harder to see that it's at stake there, right? I mean, there shouldn't be like one hidden logic that we need to find that will fit here in the political realm. And this will kind of form a square of logics. And now we know how we should act, and logic of solidarity or something like this. So I think that this, for me at least, even though now I'm looking at it.
That makes a lot of sense. That's good. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and then that was the easy part. So this is what I wanted to check with you based on that. Okay. So my idea is that I think you made very clear, especially when you added something which Attali doesn't do, which is to actually describe a small sequence in the history of musical thinking, right? Who gives a shit if, you know, it was phenomenologically constituted as matter or as resource? Like for Schoenberg, then Webern, then Varese, and so on. I mean, the problem is that you have a history where they don't really count. They're just indexing some musical works that talk to other musical works. And we're actually not really that privy to the conversation. We kind of try to keep track of something which is intelligible when you compare the songs. You have to put the music, it needs to play for us to actually see what the hell is going on, right? Whereas social worlds are worlds where people are relating to people. I mean, you can be as, you know, cool as you want with your questioning of humans, but in some level, we kind of want to be part of that world, right? And if you're not, that's actually an issue, politically speaking. So there seems to be a problem of how we move between these two things, because social worlds, they have to do with this conditions of circulation amongst people, labor conditions, technological conditions. They constrain musical means, but they can't really tell you which forms to give things, right? You didn't have to address any of that when you were describing the history of all these different emancipations of musical parameters, right? On the other hand, musical forms, which are actually worked through here, they constrain human experience in the sense that if you want to listen to this, you need to listen to that. Or if you want to listen to this, you need to pay attention to this. Something like that. There's no way around that, right? And I was thinking that there are two ways of short-circuiting this.
I've seen it. That's pretty good.
Right?
Yeah.
I think that's what you were saying at the end, that
yeah,
that little aristocrat.
The
aristocratic tantrum that Cage gives is that I know how to make some synthesis in the musical world. There is a properly musical sense of indeterminacy, which if you try to compare to a political sense of freedom, it will just sound naive, but musically makes sense, right? But then you challenge social form to adapt to it, and musicians are like, I'm not paid for this, fuck you, right? And on the other hand, you have a social synthesis, which is coming from some political engagement that Cardew has, challenging musical form, like could we make this type of avant-garde music for non-musicians and so on and so forth? But they're kind of inverted in this particular aspect, right? It looks like one is more at this arrow and the other is more at this arrow.
I agree. But then there's also the question of how this connects to what Attali is doing, because Attali is not talking, you understood correctly the presentation, because it was a kind of point of honor to have this little arch of, you know, specifically musical world, because Attali does not do that. Attali is always mixing the, you know, musical synthesis with the economic synthesis at the same time. And I think this creates a lot of confusion. So I wanted to, this is of course very tentative, but it's kind of a sketch of, you know, How about we have a method wherein you are able to, for instance, locate the, you know, internal musical and social things that is internal to the musical world, and how these are kind of governed or connected or glued together with the, you know, space of social world at large, or economics, or political economy, and that kind of thing. Because Attali just run these together. And one of the possible criticisms that we can make to Attali is that he shifts his concept of noise after sacrifice. It seems that's not really the same thing when it gets to representation, repetition, and composition. Maybe composition, you regain, and this is also a homology with Caratani, like the getting again, you know, Mode in a different kind of scale, different kind of level, in a certain sense. The indistinction between producer and consumer, like this is something that seems to be important in composition. It is important for Clumsy Cat, and it kind of enacts what Caratani wanted in a certain sense within the world of music. But the fact that you have, I think, to deal separately with the musical world and with the mediation with the social world is something that Attali does not do. And perhaps a more thorough kind of formalization of what he's trying to do, and maybe some modifications, because the book is really massive.
Yeah.
Is like, it would have to go through these steps and say, where is the nexus between the properly musical synthesis and the social synthesis, for instance.
Yeah, I mean, just to conclude, I think that this is something that the Clumsy Cat text does that's much better than Attali. I was talking to Rafael Warrior about this, because when it comes to doing histories of politics, music, or whatever, I mean, you cannot pretend like you don't have stakes on what you're doing when it comes to how you tie it to the present. You know, you're ultimately claiming, if you want to be rigorous, that because you think some things are true, that you're allowed to look at the past and they were true at that time as well. So, you know, if you are engaged with a certain type of musical experimentation and so on, that puts you, let's say, in line. You're working to make yourself continuous with something that happened before. This sort of objective theory of the whole thing, you know, bypasses that fact. And I think Clumsy Cat is clearer on this, that when you say something like, it also becomes easier to say something like, yeah, I'm not proposing what I like music because I'm obliged to, because it's the future of everything. I mean, I just want a fucking society where I can do my thing in peace, you know? I mean, there is a small difference between saying it's necessary that it should be so, and we should all fund. I should be funded because I'm producing the next thing that will, you know.
I want to do whatever I want. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, it's small difference.
Bruno has a more. It's a shame that he's not here, because he has a much stronger view of his text than mine. Like, because he says, no, you know, we solved the problem of the autonomy of the musical work in politics. With this like 8-page popular manifesto. He's much stronger than me in that. Like, of course, this is kind of funny, but in a certain sense, it is true. Like, he was part of the PCB, and, you know, at some point he was tortured with this kind of, where is the political, or the encargo social, as Mayakovsky says it, like the social, you know, function of what I'm doing. No, the social function is not that. The social function is to make it explicit that we need that. So it's not encoded within the content of the work. And this is also something that we can compare to, for instance, Cardew Great Learning Phase and Cardew, you know, Smash the Social Contract Phase, which is shitty content, but which is directly politicized, whereas the Great Learning is not really that. It's like the process that is, in a certain sense, social, political. And the fact that you want to have an environment where you can just, you know, engage with a certain form of material and come up with certain conclusions in practice, that was the scratch orchestra at the time that the Great Learning was being done. Like, something like that.
Yeah, you know, like, this is something where just to conclude, like, you know, it's weird because, I mean, there's the Benjamin text. I'm not that fond of Benjamin anyway, but like, you know, that ends with, you know, we shouldn't aestheticize politics, we should politicize art. But for me, like, I don't need what Cardew proposed. I mean, Cardew clearly was a commie. He was sensibilized by the problems of division of labor, difference in skill, things like this. And the fact that there is some collective solidarity thing that you could use. And he aestheticized the shit out of that. Like, he didn't create the revolution by getting people to... There's no problem with aestheticizing political categories. Like, if you make better music because of it or something new, I don't see the problem. Like, politicizing aesthetics as if it's like always going to be the greatest thing. And, you know, I think he, in that case, it's the inverse. I mean, he did aestheticize politics. It's a good example that you can do it with really amazing, you know, you're just submitting political forms to the standards of musical thinking rather than submitting it. Like, it's crappy stuff, but it involved like poor children sang. It's good. Like, it's a terrible criteria. We should aestheticize. We just need good political forms so we can do it. Without them, we're, you know, like, if you aestheticize bad political forms, that's, if you aestheticize fascist political forms, it's going to be fascist, yes. It's not because you aestheticize them.
I think Cassia is next, right?
Today was the first time that I read Attali, so I guess my question is more like pertaining to his thinking more generally. Like, I was like thinking about the relations between representation and fear, repetition and harmony, and composition and normality, because sometimes it feels like representation, and I think you pointed to that in your presentation, that representation somehow makes explicit or turns visible the problems that comes with harmony, and then repetition is a form of like opposing it, like. And but composition actually deals or is somehow opposed or like is generally contrary to standards of normality, if of the normal, if I get it correctly. But all the time he's talking about music and noise in relation to the exercise of power, and I was thinking if like this is a straightforwardly historical account of music, because if so, repetition, it is the case of that repetition turns visible the problems of normalization processes. I mean, like, why does normality appears just so late if the whole categorization system of music is predicated upon the exercise of power?
Yeah. No, I think there's a kind of a difference there between normality, the norm, and as such, and normalization. I think what's the difference, what's proper, specific to repetition, the way he understands it, it's normalization. And normalization is not only to, you know, uphold certain norms. For instance, this is the case since Sacrifice, right? I mean, like, Sacrifice is, enacting ritual murder because it is, you know, indexing a certain order within a certain specific order, and, you know, kind of filtering out what is accepted within a certain social form or whatever. Certain community, it's not really a social form, a specific community or such. The idea of the normal is there from the beginning. I think that the difference is that whereas what is specific in normalization is the fact that it is the dissemination of replicas that in a certain sense is kind of replacing it's replacing your active engagement with the content in a certain sense, because the idea is, I read a paper by Robin James in preparing for this, that she compares this to, you know, biopolitics in a certain sense. Is what, this is why I, in the beginning of the presentation, I was talking that he mentions that repetition is a form of bureaucratic power. I don't think so. Because a form of bureaucratic power is a kind of a disciplinary society kind of form. It's not really a society of control. What he wants in repetition is a society of control, whereby, you know, it's yourself controlling everybody else. Everybody else is controlling everybody else. This is normalization. This is dissemination of, you know, replicas, in society with no really, there's no centralized bureaucratic control. It's the opposite. So normalization in the sense of repetition is that, like, is this the prevalence of molders and, you know, of industrial production of replicas that, you know, in a certain sense, annihilates any singular experience. In a certain sense. I have a kind of hard time explaining Attali because I have to explain something that I'm not necessarily in agreement with. But I think he goes, this is kind of a picture. I think Attali is very close to Debord in that. I think like in with a situationist in a certain sense. He's when he comes to composition is like this rebellion against abstraction as such, the return of, you know, the lived time of the now and, you know, the situation, what the situation is we're talking about with the situation. And that is thought of as a kind of rebellion against, you know, commodity form and the abstraction that comes from, you know, the commodity form and this kind of thing. So does this answer? Like, I think repetition is that it's normalization that is specific to repetition, because you're not really commanding directly anybody. It's just normal. You're just you know, disseminating these replicas so that it becomes the normal, instead of having actually an authoritarian kind of order or implicitly authoritarian order. That is kind of what happens in representation. You see, like, because it is an enclave. There's an enclosure of the concert situation of the work, of, you know, what you are purchasing and all of that. There's this logic of boundaries and enclosures in representation, which is much more close to actually giving an order, like having an authoritarian kind of order. Whereas you don't need that in repetition. Repetition, you are already kind of making it a habit in a certain sense, normalizing a certain set of assumptions. I think that's the difference. Does that answer?
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
So something that I was thinking about throughout is the way that Attali does his historical periodization. I'm like kind of obsessed with how like weird and like kind of bad it is. But I feel like doing a little bit more of a symptomatic reading of that, we could get maybe some interesting insights as well. Because like it definitely does seem like, you know, if you're going to be taking Attali's schema of like the sacrifice, repetition, composition, and like lining it up with like what we're doing with Karatani. Like, I think like that is definitely like a more viable approach, and like how Gabriel responded, I think was brilliant. But if you look at how Attali does periodization, I was talking about this a little bit in the chat as well, that it's sort of like, it seems like for him, representation isn't mode B in general, but like seems to come about specifically within the context that like in the structure of world history, Karatani focuses on in terms of absolute monarchy, right? Which implies something really interesting, I think, about the relation that mode B has like to either sort of the status of empire versus like the status of the nation. Because when you have like a world empire or whatever, mode B is operating very differently from how it is operating when like it's focused on the constitution of a nation state, and also coming along with that, a national market, right? Which was really crucial to the development of like, you know, what we think of as early modernity, or like really capitalism in general, it's an overall social system in Europe, right? So I don't know, like, I think there might be some interesting additional dimension to representation. Like, I think that overall, like Attali's tendency to collapse so much of human history into sacrifice is sort of silly, but it does seem like his attempt to like look at how representation emerged in his account, like, I don't know, in some ways it almost reminds me a little bit more of Cordella's attempt to look at how like secular modernity represented a break with the sort of past forms of like, you know, aristocratic master's discourse or whatever. It's maybe in some ways closer to Cordella's periodization than Caratani's. Like Caratani focuses on sort of the passage from A to B, whereas Cordella is more focused on the passage from B to C, which is like what I was talking about in my presentation last week, but it seems like in this case, it's almost sort of like within the space of secular modernity, it's like Attali is looking at these different dimensions of sort of like, I mean, I also think the comparison to disciplinary and control societies is kind of potentially an interesting way to talk about this, but I don't know, like, I think there is also this dimension of like how we think about the constitution of a national market and like the prioritization of a certain kind of national capitalism. And like, you can still see this today in the form of like different sort of like developmental dictatorships, maybe you could argue. Then comparing that, I guess, to like, you know, more global or like international, transnational kind of capitalist, like market constitution, society of control and all of that. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that, JP, but I was thinking about that a lot sort of throughout the presentation.
I agree. I actually was trying also to mention it, that the history is a bit shady. Like there is some use to add to it, but representation, I was trying to say that like representation was already comes in Attali with, you know, commodity exchange. So at the same time, there is a part of the book that I talked very little because the presentation was already too big. That it was the time that, you know, for instance, you have the jongleur that is free, that is just doing his thing and stuff. And then there you have like the valet, like somebody becomes a domestic to a certain house. And there's a huge, huge period of history where, you know, the position of the musician is as its domestic figure. That's not really selling individual works or anything like that. Is at the service of somebody. So, but it's weird because at times he seems to include that on the representation, at times not. So it's ambiguous to me that this is already representation, because at the same time, what is kind of definitive of representation is the, you know, that little, you know, idea that you pay an entrance fee to a concert to experience a spectacle. Maybe you could argue that the spectacle may be a private one whereby, you know, certain works are produced under the service of a prince or of a nobility or whatever. It's unclear, and there is, I think, something in the middle between A and B for Attali that it's not clear for me if it falls under sacrifice or under representation. I agree. The history is a bit shady, and of course, the, you know, immense swath of human history that falls under sacrifice is kind of hand wavy, to say the least.
You know what I think helps, though? I think that clearly, I mean, besides the problem that he's a French person, therefore everything that is pre, you know, 1600s is like ruled by battalion images of everyone's killing everyone and fucking everyone, that's it. With the exception of that, the more methodological problem is that he confused the history of musicians with the history of music very often. So, yeah. For example, I can clearly imagine, let's say, a vagabond noise musician, like, you know, in society, like, I mean, it doesn't say very much about musical forms that people were just like, yeah, I know of that as well. You know, like, it doesn't say much about musical forms exactly the way that, I mean, it does say indirectly, of course, because let's say if you need ridiculous apparatus to produce some music, or if it only makes sense in a certain time that music is performed, that's where it is music, right? Phenomenologically exists as music at that moment rather than as a notation. Okay, that all that constrains something, but often he's tracking the social role of the musician and not really comparing, let's say, either how it's constraining what you get to do musically, or the inverse, like given that due to the stage of the musical world, contingent stage perhaps of the musical world at that moment, you know, let's say, because you can see a problem there, because representation seems good enough to qualify the position of musicians in a certain society, but not good enough to qualify, let's say, all the, like, the polymorphy of different standards for what counts as, you know, something that plays a functional role of that harmony would play for, you know, European music, Western music in the 1500s, that plays for, I don't know, other societies that are, you know, kalas and whatever thing in Hindu music.
Yeah.
I mean, there are standards, you need to learn them. There is, you know, the proper way of approaching them. You can evaluate if people are good at their métier or not. There is a very vague idea of professionalization or of learning trade.
Actually,
that doesn't coincide.
This is a link between, you know, the musician and the music in representation. Like, the fact that you have to professionalize, you know, it's also a factor for, you know, the constitution of the harmonic system, because you have to have a standard of judgment in a certain sense as to what you are doing. If you have a métier, if you have good skills to compete in a certain market. So this is kind of the idea. And the market, of course, there is a market also for, you know, valets or domestic, for instance, like, and it's pretty late that, you know, people are, you know, so to speak, freelancers.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty late. Like, for instance, Haydn was still at the time of Haydn, he was still at the service of a prince, Esterhazy, like this, you know, Hungarian prince. Like, it's basically at the time of Beethoven, like that, you know, people usually say that or periodize that, you know, here's a freelancer. And this is the Beethovenian revolution is connected to the fact that he was a freelancer in a certain sense.
For example, would you just say that in those contexts, perhaps we find a better device for tracking the relation between musicians and music by looking at the social conditions for some part of sound to be useless? I mean, to be allowed to be useless, right? So if you're a freelancer, that means that somebody is not like on your back saying, what are you going to do with this? Right? So you have degrees of freedom, but what happens there, you don't know, right? I mean, there is some operation of that order that seems more relevant to make the bridge between these two things rather than like a logic of determination, right? Like if you're a freelancer, you focus on this, like, God knows what you'll focus on.
I agree. I think there's a complementary between a certain determination, for instance. I think the copyright laws is a very important thing. The, the way work concept gets enforced at this point has to do, I think, with the, you know, social status of the individual musical worker, which is very different now. Its use is very different from the use in the domestic kind of regime. So this is kind of important. There's a kind of certain, I think there's a complementarity between certain things get determined by the, you know, the economic basis of, you know, the craft, how the craft is organized within society. But at the same time, there is, you know, the fact that there's of course the immanent logic that, you know, musical logic that, of course, I can discover things with the material and use them because nobody's looking over my shoulder. Of course, I think both factors play a play a role. Yeah.
Another thing that I brought up in the chat a little bit ago that I feel like would probably be interesting to maybe talk about a little bit more is like the way that Attali frames all of these different forms as like kind of strictly sequential, like they like emerged at a certain point, and like before that point they like weren't there, is I think key to like a lot of the limitations of his analysis. And like sort of what Gabriel was talking about too, it's sort of like if you spatialize the analysis and you kind of get a better, like, I think you can get a better handle on thinking about how each different form of like music making or whatever could coexist at any given time and like operate in like different contexts, different places, different ways to different degrees. Like this is also, I think, key to like how like confused the passage from like sacrifice to representation in Attali is that like he can't kind of like think about the fact that these are things that themselves can compose with each other, you know, that it's not sort of like this thing of like at one point sacrifice is the way that people do it and at another point representation is the way that people do it. But it's like I feel like it's better to sort of shift the frame to like people are already doing both sort of general kinds of things but like in different ways in different places. And like once you start thinking of it that way, the analysis can, I think, get a lot more subtle and like less forced.
Yeah, but I think he's aware of that. Actually, I think he wants that. I think maybe it's kind of, it's something that at some point he says these are mixed together. These are, there's a kind of a certain kind of simultaneity between these modes and all that. He says that so that much, but at the same time, this is underdeveloped in a certain sense, I think. And it's kind of ambiguous because it's something that, you know, gets stated sometimes in the book and never gets back to it. Like the book is very messy. So you can't, nobody who hasn't read the book can really imagine what was the effort to kind of systematize it a little bit for these two papers. Because, yeah, really, kind of, come on, like it's, so there's a problem in his kind of writing. You have to take into account that this is 1977 in France. Like, so this is why I'm talking about Debord. Like, what are the immediate antecessors? Like, Deleuze Guattari. Like, come on. Like, so there's this issue with the writing itself. That's kind of difficult to parse the system behind the writing because there is kind of this ambition of a certain systematization there, but at the same time, it's bloated. There's this kind of writing style from the epoch that gets in the way. So it's kind of difficult to parse really what is, you know, simultaneously, what is simultaneous and what is sequential. But I think he wants it to be also simultaneous. And of course, many, I have to be fair to him, many of your questions, the question of everybody, not you, Anna, but everybody else as well, many of your questions would be kind of answered by the book. Of course, this was a kind of very small kind of thread and an overview, because there are quite detailed discussions, for instance, of, you know, specific historical processes between, you know, the feudalism and, you know, the marketplace and all that, and, you know, the all the changes in copyright laws. There's a big part of the representation chapter about these copyright laws and the relationship with French, the French nobility and all of that. So there's a lot of detail that got lost out, of course, because this is a very specific, very, you know, kind of summarized presentation. But I think he wants it to be like that. Maybe just either he's incompetent at arriving at it, or, you know, maybe it's my presentation that didn't give justice to that aspect as much as it should. Go on.
So I guess to follow up on that a little bit, I'm kind of curious about then exploring the link of like what is actually happening in his thought that like leads, I think, to maybe some of the limitations there. Like, I guess you can also ask this question about, you can talk about noise and social synthesis, but can you also talk about like noise and real abstraction, right? Like, I've been thinking about this relationship of social synthesis and real abstraction also because of like the paper that we're working on. And it's kind of like, it seems like a lot of what Attali is missing is like some sense of the transcendental, right? Like, it seems like it's almost like it's a little bit too like empirical history, sort of like not necessarily, I don't know. I mean, I need to read the book seriously, but it's like, I feel like, I don't know. Do you think that there's a lack of the, of like some kind of transcendental sense, or that the idea that these forms of like music making could be like conditioning practices instead of like just sort of like on the level of the synthesis of the practices themselves?
Yeah, I haven't thought about that. I'm not sure. I wouldn't put it that way. I'm not sure. There is a problem of money is a very important problem in the book. So this is something that I want to get a better grasp at. If I'm continuing this research, this is something that appeared very, very recently to me. I really disliked the book before. It's just this, the relationship between that and what we are doing in the STP that, you know, caught me my attention now and made me reconsider. But yeah, I'm not sure I'd say that there's a lack of the transcendental, or that the transcendental is required for that. I'm really not sure about that, but that real abstraction, it seems to be something that plays a part in it without it, without that name. And money is an important thing. But I have to parse that out yet better. About real abstraction.
You know what you need, man? You need some bottle, man.
I was going to say that. I think this is a job for Escobar. The unheard voice of real abstraction.
The unsung hero.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, this looks like a work for, actually, without any joke, I'm not sure what Eske Bokelman's theory is, but it looks like something that Eske Bokelman would be talking about. But anyway, that's funny. Yeah, about real abstraction, I have this kind of course, I just gave the seminar on real abstraction. So real abstraction is that big thing. But I am more and more inclined to read Sohn-Rethel as, you know, proposing social synthesis as more important than real abstraction. So this is something that I'm working on with Moscardi, like everybody is, you know, obsessed with real abstraction, whereas I'm thinking that social synthesis is the real master concept. And I think a lot of things get cleared if you focus on social synthesis. If you go back to that, you know, Toscano paper, The Open Secret of Real Abstraction, the difference between, you know, the totality folks and the form folks, like the German Bettkritik and, you know, Neue Marktlektüre, this kind of thing, and the Italians. If you look at it at the point of, from the point of view of social synthesis, like there's no really big fight there. It's just because everybody is really, you know, caught in how you are thinking of the real abstraction and from where does the real abstraction emerge? Is it from production or is it from circulation and et cetera? But anyway, this is tentative. I'm not going to elaborate too much on that, but I do think that social synthesis now is kind of more important than real abstraction. In a sense, like it's the social synthesis that, you know, begets the real abstraction. So maybe that can bear some light in your first question, whether, you know, there's a transcendental missing in Attali. It's not that the transcendental do the work that the social synthesis is not doing. It's the opposite. It's a social synthesis that has to explain how the real abstraction that explained the behavior come about, I think. It's not the real abstraction that as the transcendental that explains the social synthesis. You see the difference? I'll say that, then I'll say no. I'd say it's not that it's lacking, there's a transcendental lacking. It's just like the organization of his thinking is messy. Perhaps it's much more pedestrian problem than that. Yeah.
I think in this case, it's a really good way of kind of making the distinction, which is the threshold between noise and what will count as a musical, something that exists musically. That's at stake there, and that forgetting of something to constitute something is a real abstraction. And what his book is doing is saying this is covariant with what are proper building blocks for organizing society. So again, social synthesis, what are the social building blocks, is kind of tracking where that limit point between noise and musical existence is, right? Yeah. So I think it also clarifies how social synthesis and real abstraction are connected. And why, I mean, real abstraction without social synthesis is trivial. Any practice that where something counts and something doesn't, practically abstracting. But the fact that this is making the whole social world cohere and the food that goes into your mouth depends on that. That's what makes it for real, you know? That's where it becomes more real, you know, than the bread.
To put it that way is almost like a new thesis, because everybody's caught in, you know, real abstraction is the thing. Like it's almost an unstated property of the real abstraction that people are interested in, is that it operates the social synthesis. But if you state it, actually you have to have the social synthesis in order for real abstraction to be interesting. Like, this is almost a new thesis. This is a paper that I write with Moscardi in a certain sense, because people are not really focusing too much on that in a certain sense, whereas it is ubiquitous. Like, it was weird to me that, you know, the possibility of real abstraction was polemical, for instance, in my seminar, that people were kind of, how come? Like, but this is kind of, you see, I gave the Gianotti paper, like the operational scheme. In the operational scheme, you have practical abstractions all the time. Like you throw a ball on the wall, he shows it that there's abstraction, practical abstraction going on. So yeah.
To be very mean, I think it's because first world theoreticians tend to be very happy that somebody's saying theory is real. So real abstraction means what I do matters. And that's not that big a deal.
Yeah,
in other places, the issue is, do you know that things you find to be very concrete are actually, I mean, things that are actually abstract, they look concrete because they are the things that tie you to a social system. So in the periphery, the fact that, you know, money counts more than food is weird because it requires you to consider the whole world. That's weird. So social synthesis sounds like the main problem, whereas I think politically it looks like the big thing about real abstraction in other places is that it's making thinking real. You know, it shows a theory is for real, and I think that's, it romanticizes
it. Yeah, that's an interesting point. Yeah.
If I could just say really fast, go ahead, GP.
No, I'm sorry.
I don't know. I agree with a lot of this, but there is something here that doesn't really sit right with me. And I think it's connected to, like, at some point I might really want to write something up about, like, I have a lot of specific objections to also, like, some, I think, like, related theoretical consequences to, like, certain forms of, I don't know if it's necessarily directly related to this, but, like, issues I've had with, like, reading people like Moshe Postone or like Michael Heinrich and like people like that. Like, I think that you know, there are specific concepts that if you don't, I guess, have a certain kind of grasp of the transcendental, or you don't have a certain kind of grasp of, like, how to think about real abstraction, I think it has, like, significant and, like, potentially damaging consequences for thought that, like, I don't know if I can really express very well right now what I mean by that, but I think there is something there that I want to follow up on more.
Yeah, this is connected to our current, you know, discussion on mode E and all that. Yeah, we've been there, we've been here before. I think it needs further, you know, fleshing out for us to understand what's at stake.
Really. Sorry, I missed the question. What was the point, Anna? Sorry. Like the thing that's not sitting right with you.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I think it. There are a lot of different dimensions to it. I'm not sure I could capture it, like, without creating a whole other conversation we don't really have time for. But I do think that there are, like, specific consequences of, like, I guess, not having a certain kind of rigorously, like, transcendental approach to how social synthesis operates. And, like, that's part of what I would maybe connect to some of the messiness and Attali and some other theorists that I think are working on similar problems. But I need to, like, make this less intuitive and more something I can actually communicate.
I think Addie had a question.
Oh, yeah, I did have a question. It's not very well formulated. I'm kind of catching up on a lot of things at once. But I was thinking a bit, because with the focus on social synthesis, it's being, like, I guess you could say, like the articulator. In, like, the different forms that we end up negotiating in, you know, the specific practices. I had a question about, like, how you would temporalize that exactly, because there seems to be a negotiation between, like, I'm trying to think of a way to phrase this without, like, lapsing to some sort of given, but, like, I guess the remainders of other forms of social organization as a starting point for a certain departure. And that seems to be, like, a key, like, nexus for the political questions. Cage in particular, I think his modality of trying to, his way of situating his synthesis proceeds in a way that is, like, pretty alienated from or detached from, like, the social determinants that he has to work with. I guess, like, the question would then be, how would you negotiate in this way, in where, right, this is also a question of transcendence, like how would you negotiate like primacy in this context? Because it is for sure the action of the synthesis that creates the forms, right? But this doesn't necessarily like remove you from maybe a certain context that it would have to embed itself in to become effective.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the $1 million question, right? But how to temporalize that? I think it's unfortunate that I didn't get to translate the Imperatives of the Illusion by Gianotti, that I think is kind of one of the best kind of approaches that I know of these problems in particular. What you're asking is, in a certain sense, what he calls the difference between the contemporaneous history and the history of becoming, that the terms he gets from Marx. The idea that you have a contemporaneous history that is the, you know, recursion of the same categories, in a certain sense, that they are kind of recursively put back onto, you know, the way the form determination is determined, so to speak. You have to kind of see two levels there. There's a level wherein like you have a history of becoming kind of articulation, where there is this framework of needs and scarcity and needs and things that you have to do in order to reproduce socially. And at the same time, the byproducts of those actions that perform social synthesis that you know pertain to the survival of the community in a certain sense. So you have to play it in two levels in that sense, like the level of, you know, the history of becoming and the way these real abstractions that are important for the social synthesis autonomize themselves in a certain way. So this is an interesting problem for me in terms of a problem. I don't have really a great solution to that, but it would go in that direction in a certain sense. I think I'm going to translate the Gianotti test. I think he has some great suggestions there that I think everybody ought to read. I've transcribed some of them in a response to Jeff in the Discord channel of the seminar, if you are interested. And I'm not sure if you check that out. There's a discussion precisely about that with Jeff there. But it's kind of too lengthy now, like just to, because there's like big chunks of, you know, Gianotti's text and comments. So, it would go roughly in that direction, I'll say. Did I answer?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Man, this was amazing. I hope it was useful to you, man, because for me it was like it was really, really, really cool.
No, it's definitely useful. I'm not sure what, but
what for?
It will be useful at some point. Yeah. I'm actually thinking of turning this into an intro seminar, so maybe.
Man, this would be so cool.
Like try to really flesh out all the historical problems with Attali's account and, you know, compare with Kabat-Attali. Yeah, let's do like a more,
man, I mean, if it
long form like that.
Fuck. Yeah, I can see this being, you know, I can see this being like a really, really, you know, I mean, this is something we didn't talk about, but I mean, we're actually gonna touch on this in the paper we're writing, but first of all, it's a historical analysis of the art form that's the closest, you know, is the most purely dealing with time. So there is such an interesting association between these two things, and temporal forms of synthesis and historical synthesis, how those two things relate. I mean, that could also be a reason why these things are so, one thing clarifies the other so much. But I could definitely see, like, even more than just like discussing Attali's, but just you know, seeing what has put into practice the things that we're doing, because it should be a better account than his, right? If we're right. So it sounds like an interesting battlefield in and of itself to.
Yeah. That's the point. It was not really to validate Attali. It was to test Attali, actually.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm sure he passes, but he has some interesting things to say.
Yeah.
And there are some interesting relations to be done, maybe. So that, there are some interesting uses for him. It's not to say that, oh, his theory is great.
Yeah. But you know, I'm just as a last comment, my impression is that, I mean, one thing that I think makes this very, very beautiful, like as a approach to things, is that I know that there are problems that connect music and social form that are very intimate to your musical practice. So it's a weird thing to see that, let's say, issues that I've seen you reading about, for example, the structure of musical reception and like constitution of the musical audience and development of musical forms in the 20th century, which is a very specific way where these two things meet. It's not Attali's main concern, apparently. But the moment that you pose things like this, it looks like, you know, it's almost like you can find a little small, very like localized point in the present, and then you can look at the whole thing from that point of view.
Exactly.
Like at some moment, like this book, which is, I remember you talking about it and saying like, this seems kind of crappy, you know. At some point you're doing something and then it illuminates the material differently. And I mean, it doesn't sound like it's exactly an example of, you know, what it means to place this all these historical problems in the light of something that is going on now, right? So I think that also gives a lot of freshness to the debate, that there are contemporary problems, which makes us contemporary of these problems that are historically happening, right, throughout this post. It's very interesting.
Yeah, that's a very generous assessment, thank you. But I do agree with, I mean, not maybe not the whole scope of that, but yeah, I think this is motivated by a very very real and personal engagement with, and practical engagement with these matters, of course. And I understand what it entails, what is, you know, what is in an involved form in what we are doing.
Mm-hmm.
And try to unfold what is involved in a certain sense.
Yeah. It just sparked again an interest for a conversation we were having a long time ago about, you know, how to navigate the fact that the moment you add audience and reception into music creation, you're exposing it to an external criteria, but at the same time, we've seen that criteria be turned into an internal criteria in genius ways. Like Cardew is an example of that. And what does it mean to navigate that heterogeneity in a way that puts musical form on kind of above just, you know, moralizing music in a way? I feel cool. Like this, pushing this discussion further actually gives more tools in that direction. And I think, you know, brings the Cardew gang back on the scene, which is, it feels like it's not exhausted somehow, right? It's so weird.
No, I don't think it's not nearly exhausted, no. I recently read that weird book by Safatli and Flumenesis. There's this kind of discussion between them. And they ask this weird question: what is a choir for the 21st century? Like, a choir is usually an image of community, or, you know, an image of an us in a certain sense. And they come up with different answers. Like Flumenesis says, for him it's Laborintus Due by Beru. Yeah, it's Laborintus. Laborintus is like very complex piece with lots of references. Sanguinetti is talking a lot of shit, and you know, and there's a jazz band and there's electronic music and all the very, very Flumenesis like stuff. And he likes that semiosis, that very complex semiosis, intertextuality and all that. Whereas Safatli offers Rothko Chapel by Morton Feldman as an example. Like, he likes, you know, what he calls a sublime by subtraction. It's not, it's sublime not because of excess, it's sublime because it lacks a lot of things, and it's got that, you know, not superficial in a bad sense, but superficial like musical, yeah. Superficial in that sense that, you know, it doesn't have a profundity. It's all visible and all of that. And I read that, and I planned to write a paper. I think that might actually, this is kind of a spoiler, I think that might end up in my response to Safat in March. Like, my choir is Great Learning. Because the Great Learning better. Has material, has a kind of new synthesis of musical material, a new social synthesis. It brings together the non-professional with the professional. It brings together a lot of dimensions that these works that they propose, as good as they are, they don't bring together.
Man, I think you need a paper that ends with like a QED of Stockhausen serves imperialism. Like, therefore, if this is like an imperial form, therefore, you know, then we've proven QED that Stockhausen does indeed serve imperialism.
So yeah, this is pretty literally what I believe, that cardio is not, you know, exhausted.
Yeah, I think so too. Okay, guys, I need to go cook.
Okay, have something to eat, folks. Thank you.
Man, it was amazing. I want to see what Rance is gonna write.
I want to see it. Very curious.
See you guys.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.